It's alive!
Dominic Lawton can be wild. Welcome to the Bad Movie Cult.
Hello and welcome to the Bad Movie Cult podcast, where each week we walk you through a film, minute by minute, step by step, and by the end we decide whether it's good enough or bad enough to be included in the Bad Movie Cult. And with me, my Bad Movie Cult Sherpa, Mr. Kenneth B. Wildeth.
Hello.
Welcome to Martial Arts Mayhem, everybody.
Mayhem.
Do you see what we've done there?
Yeah, I don't know. We were very, very clever with ape rill, weren't we? Until May rill. But, you know, this one, Martial Arts Mayhem. There it is.
And I couldn't think of a better film to kick us off.
Or a better star, at least. It's everyone's favourite. Not so favourite, perhaps. Now, I don't know. Maybe he is, maybe he isn't. I don't think he ever was. But, you know, he's back. It's our sensei and yours, Big Steve.
And it is the 2004 Po Chi Leong film, Out of Reach.
Dear Mr. Lansing, we regret to inform you that Irena Moravska will no longer be able to correspond with you.
Every year, thousands of children all over the world vanish without a trace. Some are sold on the international black market. A well-protected global conspiracy.
Human trafficking always seemed like such an uninspired phrase.
That has nothing to fear and no one to stop them.
Is it done?
Just a slight problem.
The American.
Until now.
Who sent you?
It doesn't exist.
Then why are all your friends dead?
You'll come. You'll see.
I'm Detective Lato.
Who are you?
Some have done bad things in the past. And once in a while, we find something that makes us feel better about ourselves.
Stay out of trouble.
It's my favorite moment in life.
What's that?
Well, it's when the predator becomes the prey.
Who's the predator and who's the prey?
Sometimes.
Why all of this for a girl you've never even met?
This little girl means a lot to me.
The only way out is to take the law into your own hands. Steven Seagal, Out of Reach. Coming soon.
Previously, we covered Belly of the Beast, where Seagal went to Thailand to save his daughter.
Mm-hmm.
This time, he's off to Poland to save his pen pal. Isn't that a fucking ridiculous plot?
And yet, that's the entire plot.
That is absolutely... Yeah. There is no other action hero that would put that as their plot. They have a little pen pal in Poland that he's got to go and save. Are you fucking kidding me or what?
No, but what a film.
Oh, my God.
What a film this is. Absolutely love this film. This is top-tier bullshit, Seagal.
Got a plot for you, Ken. Not just the, let me
surely,
beef it.
Surely you've already given us the plot.
Allow me to beef it out a little bit
for please,
you.
Oh, please do. Beef away, as they used to say to Stephen.
Vietnam veteran, Billy Ray Lansing, a former CSA agent, so not CIA, it's CSA.
Of course not, no.
Who now works on a wildlife refuge in northern Alaska. Already you're getting a flavour
like
of it.
Steven Seagal bingo list, isn't it? This, brilliant. This is superb.
Has been exchanging letters in a pen pal relationship with Irina Moravska, a 13-year-old orphan girl in Poland that he's helping out financially.
Oh, of course.
When the letters suddenly stop, Billy heads to Poland to figure out why. There's only one person in this film that calls him Billy. Everyone else calls him William.
Of course.
I liked Billy Ray Lansing. He sounds like a country singer.
Name. Yeah, it is a good name.
Got some keywords for you, Ken?
Yeah, go for it.
Pen pal.
Yep, obviously.
Child in jeopardy.
Okay, yeah.
Tough guy.
Oh, yeah.
I want to be a tough guy. Thrown out a window.
Damn right, it's a Seagal film, isn't it?
Shot to death.
Wouldn't that be a great title for one of his films?
Should have been. Steven Seagal is.
That's a bit of a spoiler, though, isn't it?
Yeah. More of a commentary on just how he's keeping himself nowadays.
So harsh. You be careful. Yeah. He's still out there.
Shot to death.
Yep.
Shot in the leg.
Ooh.
Shot in the chest.
Shot in the dark.
Shot in the forehead.
Bloody hell, there's some shooting.
Sword fight.
Nice.
And female rear nudity.
Oh, yeah. Classic Seagal.
One tagline.
Yes.
Makes no fucking sense.
That's how I like them.
It's a split second between hit or miss.
How totally irrelevant.
What the fuck has that got to do with this film?
Oh, I love it.
I think what we should do as well with Seagal films is have a little chat as well about the front cover of the DVDs, because them in themselves are superb. What's this one? What have we got for this one?
I'm going to have a guess. It's his big face with a gun near it. Isn't that every Seagal film?
Yes.
Yeah.
Have you got that in front of you?
No. I will do. Hang on a second. Why? Is that true? Have you got it in front of you?
No, I just added it because I thought that would be a good thing to add.
Yeah, it is. It's his big face with a gun in front of it. Imagine that.
I typed in Out of Reach and got a Gabrielle song. Oh, you're right, yes.
Yeah, and there's another picture of another character who's not actually in it that much with a gun near her face.
But holding it very oddly.
Yeah, that's not her holding that gun at all, is it? Unless she's like disjointed her shoulder or something.
Yeah, away from her body. There's the White Palace in the background.
Yeah.
And
a swordsman.
And the swordsman at the bottom.
And the swordsman.
To be honest with you, that's quite an impressive... That actually has something to do with the film.
Yeah.
Which isn't always the case with Seagal's
I'm not sure that's him from this film.
No, doesn't look like it, does it?
Although, to be fair as well, it's not a drawing of him.
No, which they do tend to be,
yeah,
don't they?
It still looks mightily airbrushed. But yeah. Can I say, before we do start this,
yeah,
I think this is brilliant, this film. This is so funny. Yeah. And it's brilliant because it's not a good Seagal film at all. But it's got so many vital Seagal points in this film that, as you said, before we even started, you've house on the bingo card straight away. It's just so mental. There's nobody else that would have made this other than Steven Seagal.
Absolutely. You talk about like tropes of action films. Seagal has his own house of tropes.
Yeah.
And this one hits all of them. This is, considering this is Steven Seagal we're talking about, this is his most mental film. And this is Seagal we're talking about.
I'm not sure I'm going to give it that crown.
Really?
Yeah, we'll have to keep going because I love doing these.
Yeah.
I really do.
I mean, we're going to be ended up covering all of his because they're all just insane.
I love doing Seagal films.
Of the ones we've covered, this is easily his most out there. This is direct-to-video territory in his...
Yeah, I think this is just so much fun. I'm really pleased I own this as well. I haven't got that cover because it's a part of a Seagal 3-in-1 DVD.
Beautiful.
I've got, yeah.
Shall we crack straight into this
bastard?
Yeah,
let's just hit it. Yeah, yeah.
I could talk about the other people who are in this film, but I'll bring them up when we get into it because no one's in this really.
No, let's just do it.
It's alive. It's alive. It's alive.
So we start off, Steven Seagal walking through the woods.
Just wandering aimlessly in some woods.
Now, we've mentioned it on, I think, every episode. I'll mention it again. The book, Seagalology, a study of the ass-kicking films of Steven Seagal by Verne, is the Bible for any Steven Seagal fan who wants a book. This fucking book is...
I can't even find my book. I can't even find my copy of this book anymore.
I have it to hand at all times because you never know when you'll need it.
Quite right.
This is nearly 500 pages, and it covers Steven Seagal from the golden era, from Nico.
Yep, above the law.
Above the law, all the way through to we're at Dark Vengeance. whichever, whenever that, past Machete. So that's pretty up to date, to be fair, actually.
It's not far off.
And it's got all of that, including his lawman fucking horrific.
Thankfully,
series.
It's not got his, I don't think it's got his general commander and all that bullshit in there, has it?
No. That's recent. That's very recent, isn't it? But all of those are in here, including executive decision, all that sort of shit. These are hilarious. He literally goes, similar to what we do, he'll go through and analyse the film and talk about each film. Each film gets its own chapter, and it's a great book. Look for it on Amazon. Seagalology, the study of ass-kicking films of Steven Seagal by Vern. This is the greatest thing that Ken's ever given to me, and he gave me Burial Ground and Necrophile, so that's the kind of
high
praise I'm giving this book.
That is some level.
But in this book, I quote Vern with his first line when he says, "Steven Seagal bounding through the woods in a trench coat, looking like a Bigfoot in a bad Dracula wig," which is the perfect way of starting this review.
Yeah.
Because that's what he looks like.
He is, though, isn't he? He's just like, sort of like just there, just walking through the woods.
No ponytail, but I wish he did have one, because fucking
what
horrible.
What the hell is going on with that?
I have no idea.
It looks like a fire hazard, doesn't it?
Kindling.
Just go up in seconds.
It's like none of it moves, regardless of the wind. That was one of our albums, shouldn't it?
Should have been his tagline.
Regardless of the wind.
That's us.
Yeah, that's our blues album. Regardless of which way the wind blows, his hair does not... Even this little bit at the back that's kind of like...
You know, like in the big... Like when we did Invasion USA.
Yeah.
You know when Chuck Norris is on that, like the airboat...
Yeah,
and his mullet is just flapping in the breeze at the bottom.
Like a shitty ham sandwich. Yeah.
This is what they should have been doing, but it doesn't move at all.
It doesn't move at all. Even the wispy bits at the bottom.
No.
You know, the shitty, ratty hair at the bottom.
It's like candy floss.
It's black candy floss,
which I don't think is ever sold.
As a character name.
For our blaxploitation period.
Yeah. Carry on.
It
does look like black candy floss is the greatest description of Steven Seagal's hair I've ever heard.
Yeah, it's really, really horrible. But still, you know, he seems happy with it. And he's wandering around the woods.
I've put balls candy floss.
You always do.
I know, damn it.
You and balls.
Bollock-flavoured candy floss.
I wouldn't even know what that would taste like, though.
Regret.
On your part, perhaps. Yeah.
This is the blackest hair I've ever seen on a man.
Yeah, and I've seen Rio Ferdinand's beard.
That's one for the English football fans out there.
During the World Cup coverage. What the hell?
Speaking of coverage, Rio Ferdinand's beard goes right to his lips.
Yeah.
Isn't that weird for a beard?
Too much beard, isn't it?
Because, like, most people, they have the middle bit and then bits at the side that are sparse. Literally right up to his lips.
Yeah.
It's beard and then just a little slit.
100% sure it's full. It's a real beard. I think it's like...
Rio beard.
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe it's not beard, it's Rio beard.
Maybe that's his franchise.
Is it a spray-on beard? Is that what you're saying?
Well, maybe that's what it is.
I think it might be.
Maybe that's the company, Rio Beard.
It's alive! It's alive! It's alive!
Eagle scream.
Oh, it's less than a minute. It's less than a minute and an eagle cries in the background.
I'm almost certain this is the exact same sound effect from Hard to Kill.
Quite right, too.
We get there and it's not an eagle, it's a hawk.
Yeah, it's not even a fucking eagle.
He's in a tiny little hawk trap. Just specifically designed for hawks on the ground. You know how often they're on the ground.
Who's setting those? Who's wandering these woods setting small traps for hawks on foot?
Peter Dinklage. That's who I like to think it is.
It's going to be somebody who's expressly interested in catching pedestrian hawks.
Yeah, birds of prey predominantly on the ground. Which you never fucking happens.
Yeah, still, they've caught one.
Yeah,
and it's only sheer chance that big old Steven's walking nearby.
Yeah,
and he hears it, and he hears that eagle cry, and thinks that sounds like a hawk on the floor in a trap. So he goes to have a look, and sure enough it is. He frees it, and he takes it home.
Yeah, shits himself all the way through it. You can tell Seagal's like, I don't think this fucking hawk's going to attack me here.
It does actually look a little bit like it, but he has a little wry smile, doesn't he? He gives us a smile as the hawk looks at him and doesn't attack him. And yeah, he just pops in his car and on his way.
Yeah, we get a voiceover from a girl.
Yep.
There's a picture of her on his dash.
Which is very odd, isn't it?
That is, yeah, that's too much.
It is too much, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know, it's introducing her character, but you wouldn't have a photograph of someone you've never met on your fucking dashboard.
No. Unless it's Carl Weathers, which I have.
Well, yeah, me too. Far from that. But yeah, but that's Carl Weathers. It's not just some 13-year-old Polish girl.
Not some little fucking orphan.
That would be weird. Yeah. Although, to be honest, I do have a picture of Annie.
Are you okay?
This fucking episode's fire, isn't it, ladies and gentlemen? Straight in.
It turns out Steven Seagal, old Billy Ray fucking, what's his name?
Lansing.
Lansing. He's joined a Polish orphanage's outreach program to chat to little orphans in Europe.
Why wouldn't he? He runs a fucking, like, what is it, wildlife sanctuary in Alaska.
I don't think he runs it. I think he just lives on it.
He just hangs about it.
Yeah.
Just hangs around.
The locals tell tales of the loping Sasquatch of the Alaskan refuge.
The Seagal Swatch. I think he's right. If he's on a fucking sanctuary, who's putting traps up there on a sanctuary?
Dinklage.
What, is it on off radar? Has he gone off the grid? Dinklage?
Yeah.
Has he? Is he living feral?
Yeah, he's tapping into the lucrative hawk black market. You know, you want a hawk ashtray.
Black hawk market?
Yeah.
is that it?
Yeah, you know that film?
Yeah, I've seen it.
You know, yeah, you want like hawk ashtrays, hawk...
umbrellas.
Umbrella holders, yeah.
Yeah. Necklace with a hawk on it.
Yeah, just the bottom half.
Yeah.
Just its legs.
Just his leg.
Just hanging like his earrings.
Yeah.
That's what he's up to. Dinklage.
Bloody Dinklage.
He's the only one doing it as well. It's Dinklage versus Seagal. That's the background story in this film. That's why I like it.
It is.
This little Polish girl is called Irena. And she says that he's enriched her life and will be eternally grateful to him.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
And she tells him how much she looks forward to his letters from the wildlife refuge, telling us that that's where he lives without actually having to show us. My note is, Ken, what the fuck is that coat he's wearing? He looks like Doctor Who.
Who?
The big grey trench coat with the red pockets.
He lives in the fucking wildlife.
Has he made that himself out of
potentially
foliage?
Yes, maybe.
He's wearing these long coats, and this is what you'll see in most of Seagal's stuff nowadays, to hide his massive girth.
He's not that big in this one.
No, but he's big enough.
He is big
compared
enough,
to what we've been covering recently. Yeah, obviously, he gets bigger.
I mean,
it, you know, towards more recent times, he doesn't even stand up in films, but he's big enough now to be lumbering, I think is what you describe him as.
Mm-hmm.
These big coats don't hide the fact.
No.
It looks like he's wearing a wedding dress.
But he's pregnant
at
the time of marriage.
Exactly.
Yeah. So we get her anyway. So we get her early voiceover saying how great he is, which is nice. It's a nice touch. Just everyone, just letting him know how fucking superb he is and how brilliant he is. We see that he's got a little postbox, W. Lansing. Not Billy Ray, but W. That's William. Then we get his voiceover.
Willie Ray Lansing.
Willie?
That sounds
or
like
Willie
a,
not.
That sounds like a procedure at a hospital.
Yep, not doing that again. Then we go. Then we get like a snapshot and a little caption saying that we're at an orphanage in Warsaw. And we get a different voiceover.
But who the fuck is this
narrator? Who the hell is this now? Yeah. Because it certainly isn't Steven Seagal. But it's supposed to be him.
So, I could not believe it.
Yeah, and it's so...
I couldn't believe it's this flagrant.
It's so unlike Steven Seagal. It's just someone else whispering a bit.
He says, "I'm glad you liked the American Indian bracelet, a true symbol of our friendship." It's got to be said that the script for the letters is fucking vomit-inducing.
It's ridiculous.
Oh, my God.
He's sending her fucking ciphers like he's some sort of, like, international
predator.
Assassin. Yeah. Yeah, he's like the fucking Zodiac Killer. He's out there. He's Native American wristbands. He's quoting fucking Napoleon. He's
oh,
like,
that gets
what the
way
hell
too
are
much.
You talking about?
I like how...
She's 13 and she's from... And she's Polish. What the fuck is he doing writing all this shit to her?
I like how, as we hear this voiceover, we watch Seagal gingerly spray an eagle with water on his talons because he's terrified of him. By the way, you've done well with the tracker puzzles I sent you. It's like, what in the world?
Oh, it's brilliant.
And you know the puzzle that he sends? You know yeah. what it spells out?
Dickhead.
It spells out friends, the number
for
four,
eternity.
The number four and ever, oh. Like he's like a little girl.
Wouldn't it be great if it was for eternity, through eternity?
Yeah,
yeah.
Honesty.
That'd be great if he actually just started quoting the dragon sound to her.
He gives her another cipher to solve and quotes Napoleon to her. He says, he who fears being conquered is sure of defeat.
What the fuck? Not true.
Why the fuck is he...
That's not even true. That's bullshit from Napoleon, that.
Why is he even quoting this to a young Polish girl?
How is she understanding a single word he's writing? She's Polish. She's an orphan. When's she learning like English? Who's teaching her that?
Fuck no.
Because when we go to the orphanage, it's not exactly like a scholastic fucking hall of fame, is it? They
no.
just do whatever they want.
Yeah.
But somehow she learns English enough to understand every bit of bullshit that he's writing to her. She understands Napoleon quotes and she can decipher bullshit from the Zodiac Killer. She's amazing.
Anyway, cut to Rosie's cafe.
Yeah, still.
Seagal's in there, sitting there, like, two chairs.
Yeah, there's only one other table in there. You'd be like, fucking Seagal's in here. Look,
yeah.
Look at the size of this guy.
Look at the size of that guy's fucking coat. Made of two different coats, this coat.
Why has he got black candy floss on his head?
Is he the fucking child catcher from Chitty Chitty Bang Bang? This is another one where Seagal will just dip in and out of sounding like a black guy. Because he sees Lewis, his old partner, I think, although it's never mentioned after this scene, and he says...
Who is a black guy, who doesn't sound anything like as black as Seagal does.
Yeah. Well, look what the cat drug in.
He's from EastEnders, that guy.
Yeah, he's from Snatch.
Yeah. Yeah,
and the firm.
Yeah, he's done quite a... I think, I'm sure, he's also in a different Seagal film.
Robbie G, his name is.
Yeah, he's in a couple of Seagal films, I think.
The things I know him from is The Firm and Snatch. This is what I wrote down.
Yeah.
The Firm, if you've not seen it, Gary Oldman, great film. Also Snatch, very good film as well.
And EastEnders. Most of the people in The Firm with Gary Oldman are also in EastEnders or Coronation Street. They all went on to do soaps and stuff.
There's a lot of, like, if you watch Seagal films, there's a lot of people that rock up that are from English soaps and shit.
Just cheap, aren't they?
Yeah,
This is when he was doing his European films because America stopped funding him.
Yeah, this is Polish funded, isn't it?
He did a lot of like East European, obviously, because he's a big fan of Russia, isn't he? So, he gets a lot of funding from them, especially in his later films.
Yeah.
But yeah, and obviously, we're quite cheap, aren't we? Us Brits.
Oh, I thought you meant us. Well, yes, exactly, yes. Well,
I'd be in his fucking film for nothing. If he paid me just to go and be in his film, I'd do it.
Damn right you would.
Yeah. I can't afford to go out there myself and do it, but if he paid me to go and do it, I wouldn't expect any other payment.
I think he's in hiding in Russia at the minute, so I don't think he should be going out there at this point in time.
I still would. If he's paying for the flight, why not?
So what did the cat drug in? It's his old partner, Lewis Morton. He's saying how much of a surprise it must be to see him here. That's what he says. It must be a surprise to see me here, right?
He says, well, yeah. But not as surprising to the owners of this diner that I'm here.
Yeah.
Because look at me.
Or the fact that I haven't finished my breakfast, which is in front of me at the minute. Here's a line, Ken, that I want you to tell me.
I could hardly finish my breakfast when my old partner walked in.
Yeah.
It was the voiceover from someone else.
I could hardly finish my breakfast. Here's a line, Ken, from Lewis that I want you to explain to me. He says, "Old Shepherd still talks about the high and mighty shit you once did for the government."
Mm-hmm. That's obvious. That's as clear as day to me. Having worked previously as an old shepherd.
Yes. Seagal took a shit for the government.
Yeah.
I suppose that's the most fucking believable job Seagal's done in any of his films for the last 20 years.
I mean, to be honest, that's government level. Isn't it one of Seagal's shits? You'd imagine the government would have to be notified.
They'd have to step in.
Step in his shit. It's the last thing they want. That's why they had to cordon it off.
And then Seagal says, "But that's in the past. We're living in the here and now."
Mm-hmm.
He slides Seagal's torn up SCA card across the table to him.
CSA.
Whatever. "You saved my ass a few times, as I recall. I owe you one, Billy Ray Lansing." I like that. "You saved my ass a few times." Let's get that in.
Why is his card all torn up?
I don't know.
And why has he got it?
I guess Seagal left the CSA and tore it up in
fury.
Lewis's face and threw it to the floor.
Yeah, anyway, he says, "Call it even." And then he just fucks off.
Slides the card back over to him.
Yeah. And off he fucks. Then he just leaves. Yeah.
And Louis offers him the handshake.
Yeah, he ain't taking that shit. You don't offer a handshake to Seagal. He'll break your wrist, throw you through a window. That's textbook.
I bring it up now. The rest of this film, Lewis is a bad guy. What the fuck is this? What's all this bit about?
I don't know. I think what he's doing is he's trying to get him back on. Back on board.
Back on his dick.
Yes, Tom.
I thought so.
Yes, he is, yeah. That's the card that he swipes down his...
his anus.
The old japper.
Oh, the other way.
Yeah.
Seagal ignores the handset. "I've put... Not sure why he offered it." And also Seagal leaves his breakfast, which is almost an impossible suspension of belief.
Yeah. He's got three other breakfasts at home, though, hasn't he?
That's true. Yeah. I didn't think about that. He's always prepared, isn't he?
He's got one in his cab as well. He's got one in his truck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seagal immediately heads back to his house and goes straight for his lockbox with the letters from Irena.
Yeah, and inexplicably just burns them. What the fuck has this got to do with anything?
He's like the CSA going to turn up, and unless he's like a paedophile.
He'd just be like that. Some guy from EastEnders walks in, says hello, and he just goes and burns every letter he's ever received from a Polish orphan.
Yeah.
Like, that's relevant to the fucking world.
Yeah. Meanwhile, in Poland, a car full of bald men pull up outside the orphanage. They open the back door, and out steps a man called Faisal.
Yeah, some lovely, lovely shoes.
Played by Matt Schultz, who's from the Fast and Furious, Blade movies, in The Transporter. Some kid pickpockets his lighter, and he turns around and blows smoke in his face. And he says, "I'll count to 10 and see how far you can run before I catch you." Mrs. Donato, the woman who runs the orphanage, she comes over.
I quite like that, because he's immediately threatening a child.
Yeah,
which basically,
you like that, do you?
Yeah, it's just basically setting him up, isn't he?
Yeah.
You've got to have a villain who shows how villainous he is.
Yeah.
And clearly this guy is the bad guy, and then he threatens a kid straight away. Not as good as Richard Lynch shooting dicks off and murdering everybody on a boat.
Yeah, with his Princess Diana hair.
Exactly. But, yeah, it's not bad.
Not bad.
This guy's not got too much like away from Princess Diana hair either, has he?
He's got the slick back.
Yeah. I think Princess Diana had that at one point.
He says to Mrs. Donata, "The thrill of the chase, it's always a constant source of amusement to me." Vern describes this bad guy as a cheese ball. I would agree.
Yeah.
Some of his lines are fucking ridiculous.
Yeah, they are ridiculous, but I like them.
We get more dubbing from someone else. He tells Irena he has to go away, but gives her his address through another cipher.
"I may be away. Reach me in a Montreal address."
Yeah. Yes, that's literally the fucking...
He's like, what? "This cipher I have attached is called Zodiac." See? It's the fucking Zodiac killer. It's like the same thing. Maybe he was. They never did fucking catch him, did they?
Well, do you reckon Billy Ray Lansing was the Zodiac killer?
Maybe so.
Mm.
Makes sense, right?
Does to me.
Yeah.
Lewis, he's back with a load of suits in a van led by old Shepherd himself.
How many fucking suits get out of that van?
It's like a clown car.
Well, why are they in a van?
Yeah, exactly.
There's nobody there. Why don't they just turn up in a car?
They're going out to remote northern Alaska as well.
Yeah.
How fucking uncomfortable would that ride have been?
Yeah, in a fucking van where they're all just sat in the back. It's not a minibus. They're just sat in the back of a van. Just like if it's carpeted, they're lucky.
Yeah, which it isn't because they're not in a fucking band. So they're literally in the back of a van going through northern Alaska, rough terrain. You just got loads of guys in suits falling over each other in the back.
Suits? Why are they all in suits? They're there to assassinate Billy Ray. So why have they got to wear a suit? Not just the uniform.
That's the job, Ken. That's the job.
For the CSA assassins. Anyway, yeah, they find his house. They park right outside in the van.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they all get up and go in.
Yep, they find the remains of the letters in the fire.
Yep, for some reason.
Meanwhile, Faisal, he's got all the kids at the orphanage lined up. He's giving them roses. Well, roses to the girls anyway, asking them what they want to be when they grow up. First one he gets to is a girl called Agnieszka.
Agnieszka.
She says that she wants to be a model. And Faisal says, well, you're not good looking enough to be a model.
Yeah, he says, that's fucking doubtful, isn't it?
And then gives a rose to Irena after she says that she just wants to be a good student.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly what he wants.
She's holding hands with Agnieszka, so they are definitely best mates.
Yes, that's right. They're friends.
Later on, she packs to leave, but before she goes, she asks Mrs. Donata to make sure her massive American friend receives her last letter.
She says, whatever.
She's loaded into the back of the cars and taken away by Faisal and his men. Slow-mo of the little boy running alongside the car.
Yeah, he's the one who pickpocketed him earlier. He's a little shit, to be honest. Doesn't get any better. Stays as shit all the way through.
Seagal.
Back at Seagal's house. Yeah, those suits. They've been ransacking his house. Ransacking it. And he gets home and he gives us an absolute beauty. And it was one of those that myself, Dom, and our friend Dave often quote to each other as when we talk about Seagal. And he just goes, Lord have mercy.
What a mess.
Yeah, and that's what he's commented on. Where the fuck has he been?
He's out protecting hawks from Peter Dinklage. Where the fuck do you think he's been?
A hawk from the Legion of Doom.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought he just left that little shack diner that he was at. He probably stopped off for a couple more breakfasts, didn't he, on his way? Yeah. He didn't finish that one.
Well, obviously, yeah.
Yeah, but he gets home. Lord have mercy. What a mess. And they're all hiding from him. Like he doesn't know they're there. The fucking van's still outside. They're all still in his house, but they're hiding. Yeah, and they all jump out and they have a fight.
Yeah, Seagal returns home. He says he'll cooperate with the suits as long as they play it by the book.
Yeah, whatever that means.
He plays along until they try to take him into the van, and this is where we get our first fight scene.
Yeah.
Lots of close-ups, lots of slow-mo. There's a knee strike that looks painful. These are Seagal fight scenes nowadays. There's nothing that's like, you don't get to see anything really. It's all very close-up.
It's all like quick edit cuts, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a shame, but, you know. Yeah, whatever.
Seagal, he takes Lewis hostage, tells Shepherd to put the gun down, and then he asks them to turn around, which they do momentarily, Lewis and the old Shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
And literally, it is literally momentary. Like Shepherd glances at Lewis, and then when he looks around, Seagal's gone.
He's gone. He's just out of there. Like a ghost. Like a phantom.
And he calls out into the wilderness. It doesn't matter how far a man runs, this is Shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
He can't run away from himself. Whatever the fuck that means.
I think that's just something that Seagal's probably written.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, mystic mumbo jumbo.
What does it take to change the essence of a man? That kind of bullshit.
Yeah.
Where you just think, Yeah, but I like that. I like the fact that he just shouted that out into the woods.
Yeah.
That entire thing that takes too long to say.
I like the thought of Seagal running just through the woods at that point.
He's just probably just wandering and he's walking again.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's just like that. Instead of just shouting, fuck you, Billy, or we'll get you, or anything like that, he shouts that.
Yeah.
Which takes ages.
We cut to Seagal. He goes to his P.O. box pretending to be French, Mr. Delacroix. He has many, many different names in this bit.
This guy looks a bit like Wes Craven, I thought, the one who works in the post office.
Yeah, he does a little bit.
Like Wes Craven's working there. He's like, Monsieur Delacroix.
Yeah.
And he looks exactly the same, but he's just not had a shave. He's got a little stubble, hasn't he, this one, Seagal?
In the book with Vern, he actually mentions that this is the most crazy Seagal looks in any film.
Yeah.
He's got stubble, he's got his crazy hair, and he's wearing a big fucking fur coat.
He's wearing a woman's coat.
Yeah. Like, what in the world?
Got a big old fluffy lapel coat, hasn't he?
Where did he grow stubble in the fucking 2 minutes it took him to get there?
He's in fucking Montreal. He's fled the coop.
Has he?
Yeah.
Is that why?
That's why he's speaking French.
I just thought he was insane.
No, he's moved. He's gone. He's out of there. He's left this wildlife sanctuary. Now he's in Montreal.
Monsieur Delacroix, qu'est-ce que la diff?
Je ne me sais pas par même jour.
Pablamous.
Yeah, that's what he says. Où est la bibliothèque?
He does indeed have mail
when
they ask him. And it's already been opened and resealed with sticky tape.
Yeah, he doesn't like that. It's just the one letter.
Yeah, typed from Mrs. Donata telling him that Irena will no longer be able to correspond with him as he's a 50-year-old man sending notes in a coded language to a 12-year-old. Which is fair enough.
Which is a red flag.
Yeah.
Yes.
In Polish. No. Okay, cut to Seagal's...
Why the fuck would you... I mean, knowing the phrase red flag.
I thought you'd know that. It's like the back of your hand.
I think Schwerzer is red.
There we go.
I don't know what flag is.
Look, you're pretending you don't know. I know you're in the fucking FBI, you bastard. Cut to Seagal sweating at himself in the mirror, nodding his head and glancing down at a picture of Irena.
He's got a UK passport there as well.
Yeah. Mr. Beamish is his name in that one. Old smudger to his friends.
Yeah, he has. Anyway, I just noticed that he's got a UK passport just hanging about the place. I don't know if he ever uses it, but still. You ever just stared at yourself in the mirror and just nodded and just thought,
I'm going to Poland.
Yeah, I'm going to just travel now.
At Faisal, he takes the girls to a massive stone warehouse.
It is massive as well, isn't it? It's far too big,
this
that place.
This is ridiculous. The doors, when they open later,
yeah,
it's like,
exactly.
how the fuck are they opening?
It's like a fucking aircraft hangar.
Yeah.
Anyway, carry on.
Irena, she goes to get a picture taken by Faisal's right-hand man, Ibo.
Mm-hmm.
He tells her that she is now in a very special foster care program for good students like Irena. And he goes through her bag, finds the shoebox full of letters from America. She tries...
the Proclaimers.
Yeah.
That'd be great if he was sat there with his guitar. Seagal, yeah. When you go, will you send back? Anyway, yeah. Yeah, yeah. And they say...
They might as well use that voice for him.
Muck Seagal.
Yeah. What would that be if that was a McDonald's?
It would be fucking everything. Everything in one burger.
Yeah, it gets given to you in a trench coat, wrapped in a trench coat.
Black candy floss as your dessert.
Yeah, instead of a McFlurry.
Yeah.
She tries to grab them out of Ebo's hand, but he tells his henchman, who's called Azimi, to burn them. And as Azimi leaves, Faisal walks in. Dressed as David Hasselhoff from Knight Rider.
Yeah, I think he's wearing Seagal's coat.
He's got the red T-shirt,
yeah.
Black fucking leather jacket.
Yeah,
it's Hasselhoff.
It's bloody Seagal.
It's massive though. Yeah,
it's fucking enormous.
Yeah, it reaches right down to the floor.
He wears that coat in Into the Sun, I believe, on the front cover.
Oh,
he's
yeah.
wearing that one. Yeah, where he goes back to Japan.
Mm.
Yeah, that's a huge coat. It's too big for him, which
yeah.
is why I think it's Seagal. I think he kept that. I think Seagal kept that coat and then wore it later on.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a massive coat. Anyway, yeah, he walks in and has a look at the letters and he says, I haven't seen a cipher like this for a long time.
Since I was molested by Count Dracula.
On that sanctuary.
Yeah.
With the hawk from Legion of Doom.
See, you know when he says, I haven't seen a cipher like this, blah, blah, blah,
mm.
that makes you assume that him and Seagal have a past.
Yeah, but of course not. let's not fucking get involved in that. It's just okay.
Is that, did you assume that as well, though?
Yeah, but to me, I think it's just going to be one of those, it's a military cipher. That's what I think it has to be at the end.
He's supposed to be on the opposite side. You can't have a cipher if all sides know the fucking cipher.
Yeah, but he's a fucking English-speaking military man.
Yeah, but he's called Faisal, and he goes to the Turkish embassy, so I'm assuming he's supposed to be...
Seagal goes to the fucking Russian embassy.
Yeah, but he's Russian at this point, isn't he, Seagal?
Ah, you see, come on. They're all bloody mercenaries, aren't they? Doesn't mean they all didn't originate from the USA.
The USA Cipher Academy.
That's the whole point, isn't it? That's what they say, the shadowy situation of shit.
But old Shepard doesn't know who Faisal is, so...
He's not been around for life.
Of course he has, look at him.
Okay, but he doesn't know everybody, surely not.
Of course he does, look at him.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, you win that with the same thing twice.
Yeah. Ibo tells Faisal that Arena will now be called Lola.
How do you spell in that?
L-O-L-A, Lola. La-la-la-la-la-la. And then Seagal comes in. Well, I'm not the world's most passionate man.
Oh, no, you don't want to be singing that.
Cut to Faisal and Arena's mate, who wanted to be a model, Agnieszka.
Yep.
She's been dressed up and dolled up. She's sitting in front of a camera. Faisal comes over and tells her to look into the lens and tell them about herself, saying all professional models suffer from stage fright, so it's okay to be nervous.
He's not overly subtle at this point, is he? He's a bad guy.
Yeah, this is ridiculous.
He might as well just say, look, you are kidnapped now.
Yeah.
But he doesn't, he's still pretending. She doesn't fall for it, of course.
And, of course, she's not got half a brain removed.
Yeah, and she escapes into a very, very slow-moving lift.
Yeah, I like that when she's like...
elevator that just like, you could, I don't know, you just walk faster than that.
She could have, gone down the stairs. It's actually very surprising how easy it is to get away.
It is, yeah.
In the first instance.
Yeah.
I like how when she's sitting down and he's like, oh, just be natural for the camera. There's a guy with paparazzi, photos, in her face.
Oh boy, what a scoop.
It's like, what the fuck is this? Meanwhile, it turns out Seagal has only gone and flown to bloody Poland.
He's turned up, hasn't he? He's arrived in Poland.
Under another pseudonym. He's just full of pseudonyms, this man.
That's him.
Faisal, he stops Agnieszka, who's trying to escape, by saying, you can try to run, but there's nowhere to hide, and now I'm forced to make an example of you.
That's when the warehouse doors open, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's such a great fucking look. It takes far too long, though. That's the problem.
You know what? When you mentioned the coat, I actually thought it was Seagal walking in, lumbering in.
It should have been, because it's a great thing. I don't know how he got outside when he was inside previously.
Yeah. But he's just waiting for someone to escape.
But he's now gone outside and waiting by the big doors.
Mm.
And those doors are fucking enormous. And they open, and he's got the light behind him, so it's a silhouette. And wearing his long coat and everything, doing all that. And... it takes fucking forever, doesn't it, for those doors to open?
Yeah.
But he does. He looks absolutely brilliant. Yeah. And then he just says, now I've got to make an example of you as soon as I get there. Some fucking miles away at the moment. I'm over here by the doors.
Little lad at the orphanage steals Seagal's sunglasses from his pocket.
Yeah, because that's where he's gone. Obviously, he's gone straight to the orphanage. And
Seagal notices and kills him.
Yep, just snaps his neck. That's that kid dead.
He says to him, you're fast, not quite fast enough.
Yeah, and then she goes...
Yeah.
And just punches his head clean off. Shame, but, deserved it. Fucking thief.
It takes the sunglasses back off him. Goes, heads inside. He speaks
It's not his voice again at this point, is it?
No.
It's somebody else's voice, because I think Seagal did say, you do that again, I will fucking kill you.
Yeah.
So they dubbed over the top.
I do wonder, what they changed. Is the pen pal bit even in the original?
It's got to be. It's his fucking daughter again, is it? Why the hell would she be in an orphanage in Poland
There's a lot of stuff where it's where he's talking about the pen pal part of it, where that's dubbed. So I don't know if it's originally it wasn't a pen pal, it was
the daughter of an old colleague.
Yeah, or he's just in the CSA looking into people disappearing and they changed it to a pen pal.
To be honest, the pen pal, whole plot of a pen pal is totally fucking ridiculous.
Yeah, so I love it. Absolutely loved it.
So when you, maybe, yeah.
When you told me that there was a film with this premise, I think we watched it at your house like years and years ago after fucking, we used to go and watch like the football on a Saturday back to your house for a few like films and stuff, didn't we? And this was one of the late night beer induced. I was like, what the hell are you talking about? And I remember watching it like, what the fuck? I didn't even realize he made this film.
Yeah.
He speaks to Mrs. Donata about Irena, and he notices that she's holding a file with the Itara Foundation logo on it, mm-hmm. and she covers it up. She tells Seagal, who's had a haircut now from the trip to Poland, like he hasn't got the long flowy shit at the back now. It's more...
It's still slick back, but he looks more... Yeah. Like, reasonable.
Is that what he was going for? Like, wilderness man? Like, so he's flicked the bottom bit out a bit?
I don't know.
It's not a good look anyway, Steve. A little boy at the window, he points to the bed frame where Irena slept, and there's a cipher that she's etched into the bed frame there. Mm-hmm. And Seagal nods and says, Napoleon. You know, like Da Vinci Code, where Tom Hanks is like, Da Vinci, this is the Napoleon Code.
Yeah, was this first?
This was first.
Well, there you go then. Fuck you, Dan Brown.
Oh, it might not have been first before the book.
Okay, fuck you, Tom Hanks.
Yes, no one ever. He asks Mrs. Donata if she doesn't mind if he speaks to the police about the case. She says no, but questions if his colleagues would want him to return to America shortly. And what does he say he's from? He says he's from the...
Some sort of fucking company.
Fund, isn't it?
Yeah, some sort of funding company.
Seagal ignores the question, thanks for a time, and then throws her out the window.
That'd be great, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Thank you for your time. And then just fucking snaps her elbow. Yeah. She rings Faisal as soon as Seagal's gone and tells him about Seagal asking questions.
Yep, some massive fucking guy's just turned up in a suit.
In a Dracula wig.
Yep.
She tells him that she wants out now. There's too much heat on the orphanage.
Yeah, she said if there's anything else that happens, she's quitting. And this is it. And she's quitting.
Yep. And Faisal, he turns up at night as she's locking up. There's a lot of quick cuts from like what's said to this is the outcome of that.
Yeah, it's weird because he says, did he say anything odd? And she says, yeah, he said something about Napoleon.
Yeah, and he flips his head, yeah.
Oh my God!
Yeah.
Yeah, which again, as you said, might suggest that Napoleon's been going on for fucking ages and he knows ciphers and he's like, fucking hell, it's not Seagal, is it?
Yeah, but that's what you were to assume.
But no. It's just all of this. It doesn't mean anything. Seagal's, none of it means anything.
Seagal's protege is what you would assume.
Yeah, but no. It's just somebody who walks around keep mentioning Napoleon.
Napoleon, he says. A soldier, an emperor. But still to some, just a little corporal. It's like, what in the fucking world is that line? What the fuck does that mean? And to add insult to injury... He sets fire to a rose. It's like...
Yeah, he turns up at the orphanage, sets fire to a rose, and then off screen just kills the old woman.
And he says when he sets fire to it, he says, pretty, isn't it? But like any rose, a company must cut its thorns. It's like, what are you talking about? That's not even a cool thing to say.
No, I thought it was pretty cool.
You fucking idiot.
Yeah, and then there's a scream, and we cut straight to Steve, who's hearing a voiceover that she could not possibly have ever written.
Yeah, well, where's he hearing this?
I don't know.
Is that in the cipher? Is he?
Yeah, but it's like something that she doesn't even know.
But she actually says, "I'm not even writing this down. Yeah, I just hope you can find me."
So how the hell is he hearing it? Because she hasn't written it. She says she hasn't written it. Yet he's hearing it.
But if you would have had shots of her, you would just assume she's thinking it.
Yeah, but you've got shots of him. Yeah, you've got shots of him reacting to it.
Yeah, looking up into the sky. It's like, what the fuck's going on?
It's alive!
Just want to quickly round back to the rose thing. So this is clearly his sort of little affectation that he has as a bad guy, where he has a rose with him at all times, offers it to girls he wants to put into a human trafficking ring, and also... as a death sentence for victims, yeah?
I guess so.
My question, Ken, is if you were a bad guy, what would be your calling card?
Ooh. I don't know. I mean, I quite like the flower thing.
Mm. and like a calling card and what your sort of serial killer name would be?
I think mine would be a can of beer.
Mm. Just left at the scene.
Empty.
Well, that you've drank.
Of course I will. I'm fucking leaving a full one. What a waste of money.
What would you be called? The pisshead?
the drinker.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. No, because that's DNA, isn't it?
Well, not if you pour it into a glass and then take the glass with you. There's always a glass missing from the scene of the crime.
Well, I'd have to take it from the scene.
I don't know, you're not bringing your own pint glass with you, are you?
Of course I am. It's a tankard. Yeah. I'm going to bring in my special embossed tankard.
Is it like a German like shoe?
Yeah, massive with a lid on it and everything, yeah. I don't know. That's a good one. Playing cards are quite common, aren't they?
Are they?
Well, yeah, you can get them anywhere, can't you?
Oh, sorry, I thought you meant like in serial killers.
No.
I think only the Joker.
Really? No, the bloody sniper. Washington sniper left playing cards as well.
Did they?
Yeah.
Hmm.
So, I don't know, that's a bit too obvious then in that case. A balloon animal.
Would it change or would it always be the same balloon animal?
If I learned how to do more, yeah, it'd be different ones every time.
He knows the one. Just a dog.
It's a snake.
Just an inflated balloon.
Just a balloon.
Just left at the scene.
Yeah, why not?
Well, mine's similar. What I would do, Ken, is I would leave a kielbasa.
Oh, nice.
Hanging out the flies of all my victims.
Very Polsky as well, yeah.
Yeah. And a bread roll shoved down the throat.
Why? What would that signify? What would that...
Oh, bread roll and a kielbasa. They'd call me the footlong lover. What do you think? You like that?
No. They're separate. You get a bread roll in the throat. How are you getting it in the throat? Would it just be hanging out the mouth?
Shoving it in there.
With?
My fucking
hands. The kielbasa.
Yeah.
You're not getting it in the throat.
You know, like in Silence of the Lambs.
How are they dead? How are you killing?
Bread roll in the throat.
Do you know what? That's got to be a long and protracted death, hasn't it?
Exactly. The footlong lover doesn't fuck about, mate. Do you know how in Silence of the Lambs, when they do the autopsy and they find the death's head moth in the throat?
Yeah.
That's what they're doing here, but...
It's a fucking footlong fucking it's a bread roll. It's like a baguette.
Yeah.
They'd be able to see it.
Exactly. That's what it's not as... I didn't say it was as impressive. I'm just saying that's
it's
where
not
I got the idea.
As subtle as a death head moth, no?
No, exactly. I'm not breeding death's head moth just for that shit.
What are you doing?
Just to tell you I'm fucking making a suit of women.
Just going to the shop and buying some baguettes.
I'm just cooking them myself. I'm fucking hell, mate.
What,
come on.
Baking your own baguette?
Yeah.
Fuck off, are you?
I can bake a baguette.
No, you can't. Surely that's more effort than breeding moths.
You think
moths.
It is? Witchcraft? Is there any bit of flour?
That it?
A bit of flour and water and a bit of yeast.
Bit of bloody yeast in there.
Yeah.
No chance. You ain't fucking baking
baguettes. We're looking for a baker. That's what they'd say.
Master baker.
Look at the quality of this baguette. This isn't no store-bought shit.
No chance. No chance of you fucking going through all that for this.
No, I mean, at the store buying kielbasa, I might as well buy the baguette.
Exactly.
As well.
I mean, you're not making your own fucking sausage, are you? You filthy beast.
I could make it out of my previous victim. You just got a foot missing.
Foot long.
Yeah, exactly. Foot long lover.
So where did you get your first ever kielbasa from? Surely that was a bought one.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. That's how they find you.
What, were they just arresting every Polish person who buys a kielbasa?
Tack.
Exactly. All the Polish love kielbasa.
They do, yeah.
So, you know, they wouldn't think for a second it'd be old Dommy Lawton.
Of course they would, because they'd be like, have you had any non-Polish people buying this ridiculous sausage? And they'd say, yes, only one. And it was old Dommy Lawton.
Yeah, but I wouldn't turn up saying I'm old Dommy Lawton from foggy London town. I'd just buy the fucker and leave. I'd dress Polish.
What's that entail?
A leather jacket and fucking tracksuit bottoms.
That's true. Nailed that one.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, that seems fair enough then. Looks like the footlong lover lives another day.
Thank you very much.
Nice one. That fucking ruined mine then. Mine's just a partially inflated balloon nearby.
Oh, partially inflated.
I ain't got time for that shit.
You take a gas canister with you to inflate them?
No.
Too much.
No, I ain't carrying that around.
Especially if you have to chase him, you got to carry the gas canister with you.
No, it's just going to be like, oh yeah, DNA. DNA if I'm blowing it up. Right, okay, that's the balloon out. It's good this, isn't it? We can actually like work on how to be the best like clue-leaving serial killer.
So who do you think's better? Do you reckon it's the footlong lover or do you reckon it's the drinker? What do you call yourself? The inflatable fuck.
The inflator.
The inflator. Or the footlong lover. Which one? Who would you prefer to be killed by?
The balloonist.
The balloonyac. Have you got balloons wrapped around you? You just say you're squeaking up the fucking corridor.
Yeah, I float.
One on your head.
I float, which is why I don't leave footprints.
That's fucking nightmare inducing. Can be wild, fucking floating outside your fucking window.
I have to
asking you to blow into his fucking balloon for him.
I have to add balloons to attain certain altitude.
Do you put two up your shirt and pretend you've got boobs?
Always. Mainly, I just hover off the ground a little bit. But if I do need to attain higher altitude, I will attach more balloons. If I'm going like up a tower block. For victims.
You're just standing outside the place blowing balloons up until you get the right amount.
Yes.
What a great criminal this is. Jesus Christ.
It's why I'm about being
6 hours to get the right amount of balloons to lift a human man. Fucking 6 foot fucking four or whatever the fuck you are.
This is why I've never been caught.
You're not even small, Ken. You're fucking 6'4".
Yeah, but I don't weigh much. not with balloons.
Yeah, but you got to take your gas canister with you as well. Don't forget.
We'll have to take can't that leave with that. Me. Yeah. Now that I'm dealing with helium, I'm going to have to. Yeah.
Yeah, just do it with breath and realise that it doesn't make you float.
Just walk around with loads of balloons.
Just on the ground.
Just on the floor.
Yeah, hoodlums anyway, they turn up. Enough of the balloonyac.
When he's on the phone to the police, he does speak Polish.
He does, yeah.
Yes, yeah. Mm. Yeah, which I noted down because I quite like that. Because I know he often does that, doesn't he? He does the affectation of other cultures. Yeah, he does. He says, dziękuję, which of course means thank you in Polish. Yeah.
He already spoke French earlier in the film as well, so already we know he's a man of travel.
Yeah, he's out there, he's out and about, and he can understand Hawk.
Seagal does the old massive jacket in the shower routine.
Yeah, very
clever. To fool them.
Very clever.
Lure them into the shower room, and as they shoot out the glass in the shower, Seagal attacks them from behind.
Yep.
Throws one of them out the window, but the window's open, so no smashing through the window, unfortunately.
Not yet, no.
The guy hangs on to the curtain. Seagal grabs the curtain and is like, who sent you? The guy doesn't reply within the first 5 seconds, so Seagal simply lets him fall.
Yeah, he's probably there thinking, I'm Polish, I don't understand.
Yeah, that's true.
But still, never mind that, just die.
Yeah, it didn't happen to the other guy. I think he just got hit a little bit with the gun.
Yeah.
And that was enough. And then lets that guy fall.
That's what I mean. There's always one. There's always one hoodlum that, like, it's always the last one that gets killed. Like, one of them just gets, like, beaten unconscious, but he'll be okay. Whereas the other one just gets murdered.
Mm.
Yeah. You feel like for the other one, he just wakes up and thinks, shit.
Yeah.
Now, what does he do? Does he go and tell him?
Yeah.
Does he go and tell his boss, or does he just fuck off?
Where's Peter? Where could Peter be?
Where is Hoodlum Peter?
And he's embedded in your car from a height.
Yeah, but he does, yeah. So he does get some glass smashing because he just falls out and smashes into a car. And the mariachi band, the Polish mariachis, are outside and they all look upstairs. And look, it's not even fucking hiding. It's Steven Seagal leaning out of a window. So like,
Yeah.
But still, never mind.
Yeah, we'll never mention that again.
No, it's fine. Yeah, cut.
The police never mention it, and he's with them all the time now for the rest of the film. He goes back to the orphanage the next day, and we find out that Mrs. Donata was murdered.
Yep. I'll tell you what, though, he looks fucking good in this. He's got a suit on, hasn't he?
Yeah, I haven't seen him in a suit for a while, to be honest.
He looks really good. I did make a note of that. I think he looks really sharp in a suit.
He usually wears any old shit, doesn't he, now? Yeah. Nowadays, it's like a silk kimono, just out and about, like it's normal.
All the time, yeah.
He talks to the little boy, we find out it's called Nicky. Gives him his sunglasses, saying he looks cool. I like how he says he looks cool as they watch the burnt body of his carer loaded onto a gurney.
Yeah, not sure how he's got into this crime scene. Or why they're just letting the kids roll around as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Like the kids are just wandering about while everyone just takes corpses out. Still, never mind.
He tells the lad to give him a call sometime and gives him his phone number. And this is when Detective Lato walks in and asks, "Who the hell do you think you are?" And Seagal looks inwardly at that question.
Yeah, and then somebody else answers it because it's a different voice again. But it starts saying, "What does it take to change the essence of a man?" No, not this time. But yeah, it's someone else he answers. And
he says, "I'm Bill Hill. I'm with the Global Relief Fund."
There is an impressive amount of just nonsense companies mentioned in this film, isn't it?
Yeah, and he's always got a backstory. That's the CSA for you, though, isn't it?
Yeah, even though he's not part of it.
No.
So fuck knows who's creating all these backstories for him. Every time he makes something up, they've actually check it, and he's like, yeah, that matches.
Well, that's what happens now, because she isn't happy with the fact that his voice is now someone else's. So she's
furious about it.
So she tells him that he needs to come down to the station with her. Meanwhile, Faisal, he's meeting some British paedophile who compares selling children to a hand with fingers that stretches out across the globe. He tells Faisal to wind his dick in after he saw what happened to Mrs. Donata at the hands of Faisal. And he says that there can be no further exposure, and I don't want to discuss this ever again.
That's a guy called Nick Brimble who plays that guy.
Yeah, he's been in a Seagal film before, hasn't he?
He's also been in English soaps. He was in fucking Emmerdale.
Jesus Christ, yeah. It's all linked, people.
Yeah, so it's like he's a British actor as well. He mentions chess as well, doesn't he?
Yeah,
he gives us the hand stretching across the globe. He gives us a chess reference.
His chess reference is just think of it like just think of human trafficking like chess. If you don't protect your king, you're on the road to ruin.
Yeah, a classic analogy about chess. Yeah, the road to ruin, the old chess nut. Morris Chestnut, of course, was a bad guy in Under Siege 2.
He was indeed, yeah. Also, while we're on the Under Siege 2, it's my favourite... is it Under Siege 2? Which is the one with the train?
That is, yeah.
Yeah, that's my favourite front cover of a Seagal film.
Dark territory.
Like, what the fuck has that got to do with...
hanging on the edge of a train.
Yeah, that doesn't happen in the film. Like, what the fuck is that?
That's him, yeah.
I loved it. So, yeah, so he warns Faisal not to expose himself any more than he has done.
Yeah, and please do not expose me, Nick Brimble, from Emmerdale.
Yes.
That's what he says.
Seagal takes a seat in the police station, and while Detective Lato takes a call, Seagal manages to hack the mainframe with someone else's hands.
He does, doesn't he?
You seen the hands that are typing?
Yeah.
They're the hands of either a teenage boy or a woman.
Or a pig. Pig's trotters.
Yeah, well, if they were Seagal's, they would. But this is a young man's hands, and he searches for...
He does that, I believe, in... what's the one where he plays an author? Is it Driven to Kill? Where he plays like a Russian hitman-turned author, and he's on a typewriter all the time writing his memoirs, and that's him on a keyboard for real. And he's just like, one button, looks at the screen, one button, looks at the screen.
Yeah.
Classic. Yeah. Classic typist.
Yeah. This is why you look at this and he's typing
yeah,
away.
But this one, he's absolutely frenzying. It's yeah. like bloody Liberace on the keyboards.
He's got the slender hands of a woman in this. And
he somehow manages to crack the Polish passwords that he gets prompted to input in. It's like, how's he doing all this?
I'm telling you again, it's kielbasa. That's the go-to password for all Polish people.
He's not putting in... foot-length lover.
Foot-long lover, you son of a bitch.
Sorry, I've misquoted.
Not the foot-length lover, that's one of your films. He searches for Arena's name on the missing persons list, and there's no record of it. He looks through the list of exit visas and sees lots of girls around the same age who have applied for a foreign exit visa through a company called the United Alliance of Nations. That's vague, isn't it?
He's very, very clever, isn't it? The way he's just skirting around the actually naming the real organisations.
Yeah.
So clever.
Lato, she comes back saying they've had a call. They've called the Global Relief Fund. And
yeah,
his
he's
story...
back in his seat, by the way.
Yeah.
When she comes back in, he's not even sat there at the keyboard anymore. He's gone. He's back where he was.
Yeah. She says that his story checks out and he's free to go, providing he leaves his contact details. She sits back in a chair and then she realises it's been adjusted. The seat's like further back than it used to be.
Like there's 3 foot back.
Yeah, there's sweat on the seat.
There's a kimono on it.
And there's black candy floss all over the keyboard.
Still, she thinks, oh well, whatever.
Ebo and Faisal are fencing now.
Yeah, it's a great fucking absolutely would never happen bad guy moment, isn't it?
Yeah, Faisal turns out he lives in a white palace.
Doesn't he just? What a fucking place this is.
In the middle of Poland. Is there a lot of these in Poland?
Yeah,
white
there
palaces?
Is. Yeah.
There is.
Yeah. White palace.
Diamond dancing everywhere.
Yeah, that's what I say whenever I see one. Yeah. I'm going to Poland, actually, 2 weeks. Obviously, when this gets released, it'll be in the past. But I'll already have been by then.
He could have been killed out there.
Yeah, if I ever stop messaging Dom with other films we should cover...
I'm heading out there.
I hope he comes and finds me.
I'm heading out there. Hi, I'm Bill Hale. I'm from... That's what I'll be like.
Yeah, we'll be sending each other ciphers.
Unfortunately, I'm barred from
my time.
Unfortunately, I'm barred from Poland and wanted as the footlong lover.
Well, I'll be travelling there by balloon.
So, if I don't hear from you, you're still just on the way, or a gust of wind has blown you off course.
Yeah, or it's burst.
Yeah,
and I'm dead in the sea.
Just a man with covered in balloons just fucking rolls onto the shore, just terrifies a bunch of kids.
It's not the safest way to travel, but it gets me bypassing the passport office.
Yeah, it's worth it, isn't it? Yeah. Anyway, more of this on this fence. They're all in white in a white palace fencing.
Yeah, it's brilliant. He's like in Hard Target where he's playing the piano, and that's like the basic. That's the rich genius. That's how you do it. Yeah, you sit in a big house,
playing
the piano, and everyone thinks, "Wow, he's an evil genius and he's superb."
Yeah,
this guy ups that one.
Yeah, he does. Yeah,
I mean, I'm pretty sure he can't play the piano, but he's fencing like an absolute Olympian.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's great. It's great. There's no point in this.
Even in Hulk Hogan, isn't it? Perfect Weapon.
Yeah. Yeah, they do a bit of fencing.
Ultimate Weapon?
Yeah, Ultimate Weapon. Perfect Weapons,
Jeff. He's fencing, but he also is playing the piano.
Yeah, so he can do both. So he one-ups Lance Henriksen and Faisal. No way.
Unbelievable stuff. Matt Schultz.
Yeah, no.
He asks Azimi, who turns up, about the American, and Azimi tells him that he doesn't exist. And then Faisal says, then why are all your friends dead? He's
that's
got him, hasn't he?
Fair point, isn't it?
There's a really weird, almost Twin Peaks-style scene now, with Arena drawing a cipher on the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns out that this mirror is a two-way mirror, and on the other side is Faisal with a spotlight on his face, like he's about to sing fucking Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah, which he does.
Yeah. He's telling her what a clever girl she is.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure this is his voice.
It's not. No, this is a voiceover as well, isn't it? So yeah. He's not even saying this. It's really fucking weird.
But the spotlight, this is very like... Honestly, I looked at it, I was like...
I think...
Was David Lynch just fucking directed this bit
just,
now?
Just popped in for a Seagal film. Yeah, probably. If anything's going to get him back in behind the camera, it's Steven Seagal. With That's a pen true. Pal.
How often have we said that, though? We've said it more often than you'd think.
Steven Seagal losing his pen pal. That's stupid.
This is coming from the guy who thinks he can balloon his way to fucking Poland.
Well, we'll fucking see, won't we? We'll see in 2 weeks. We will see. We will see.
Ken just floated out of the window.
It's alive!
He says that he can see why Seagal is so fond of her and why he himself cannot let her go. He says it's time to devise a killer plan for Mr. Lansing, and then he fades away from the scene.
Yeah.
Ridiculous.
It's a two-way mirror. It's like, surely having a light on yourself would fucking highlight the fact that you were stood there.
Fucking hell, look, there he is there. Faisal. Irina then starts using a roll of roll-on deodorant to carry on with the cipher.
Mm-hmm. Very clever.
Can I just say as well that... Well, no, we'll get to it. We will get to it.
Damn right we will.
Seagal is called by Detective Lato to the stone warehouse from earlier, which is now the crime scene. Lato shows him a handwritten note they found there next to this... She shows it him, and he's when he gave him his contact details, she's cross-referenced the handwriting. Luckily, they had the handwriting expert with them at the crime scene. And she says, "This is your handwriting, undeniably." And Seagal does say, "You're right, it is."
That's undeniable, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, Can't deny it.
I mean, it isn't, because like she just thinks all this kinds of looks similar. There's no proof that it is.
But it is.
He could have just said, "No, it isn't. You've wasted my time bringing me out here. Good day."
Why on earth am I being called to a crime scene?
Yeah.
Is perhaps what he could have thought.
I'm...
If he wasn't involved in the crimes.
I'm Mr. Hale from the funding for...
From the American funding agency.
Yeah, why are you inviting me out here?
I don't want to see bodies of corpses and shit. Bodies of corpses.
I liked it.
Yeah.
That could be a name of a Seagal film.
Bodies of Corpses.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like it. Yeah.
He plays Bill Hale from the American Funding Agency.
I used to know somebody called Billy Hales.
Was it Steven Seagal? Undercover?
Oh, my God. It was the physio at Watford Football Club.
Oh, really?
Yeah, maybe it was Steven Seagal. It's doubtful.
Yeah, was there a lot of broken wrists at Watford around that time?
More than you'd imagine. Yeah. It would be, yeah.
Like glass injuries.
Son of a bitch.
Imagine explaining that in the press, the manager. Turns out Steven Seagal was our physio. So he was breaking arms and throwing people through windows.
Yeah, he's gone now. We've had to let him go.
The serious acting from Steve now as he sits down on a chair and pinches the bridge of his nose. When he's told they found his letter on the body of a girl.
Mm-hmm.
I assume that was Agnieszka, is it? Because she gets mentioned...
Yeah, it is, yeah.
It is, but then yeah, later...
But obviously he's, without looking at the corpse, he thinks it's the other one.
Irena. But then later, Irena says that she hears the screams of Agnieszka and what's happening to her and stuff.
That's probably just in her head.
It's not a continuity error. It must be in her head.
No, that's just, like we still hear the screams from Vietnam. Like I do.
Yeah.
Maybe I close my eyes.
Yeah.
It's that. I think that's what she means.
Okay. And Seagal, obviously, he's a Vietnam vet in this, even though it's never mentioned.
Yeah, I did think that was odd. Yeah, it is never mentioned, is it?
No.
Apart from in the blurb.
Yeah. We get slow-mo as he remembers a time Irena laughed in a playground, even though he was never there to see it.
Yeah, because he never met her.
You ever done that, Ken? You ever remembered someone else's thoughts?
Yes.
I thought you had.
Many times.
He's holding the American Indian beads he sent her for friendship earlier in the film.
Why has he got them?
I have no idea. Where have they come from? He just picked it off the burnt corpse of the child.
Why has she got them?
Yeah.
Did Irena give Agnieszka them? as a sign of her friendship again.
This is a... No, maybe the bad guys have taken it off.
Well, they fucking know. Or maybe... Or what, they read every letter? They just burnt them.
Did they, though?
They
didn't
fucking
see that.
Read them.
You didn't see them burn them. They were going to burn them, and then Faisal took them off.
Then he found the cipher.
Azimi, yeah.
Yeah, then he thinking, I better read all these.
I better read
see
these.
If there's any American Indian fucking...
Telltale signs, yeah.
Friendship bracelets
I know,
involved.
I know of Napoleon, and I know of this cipher, but I don't know of this man.
And that is what's troubling me the most.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
So, yeah, he's holding the beads. He sent her for friendship. And we get another slow-mo of her wearing them and him remembering her wearing them.
Mm-hmm.
Lato watches all this, obviously connecting it all in her head. And she takes Seagal to the mirror with the words, I was here, written on it in lipstick.
Yeah, and then he instantly thinks, I wonder if there's something else written on here in deodorant.
Well, there is. There's a drawing of a pair of bollocks underneath.
Yeah, that was me. I like to do that. Ever since I watched this film, I've been doing that.
The Balloniac. The telltale sign.
The Balockiac. It was, it's something I like to do.
It looks like Lato's taken Seagal to a Weatherspoon's toilet with the old bollocks underneath it there.
Yeah.
Yeah, Seagal examines it.
It's good, though. I quite like that.
And luckily, the roll of deodorant was left behind, opened on the table for them.
Yeah, thank goodness for that.
Seagal, he uses it on his tongue as he has a thing. And
I like the fact that he goes to the Lion Hotel and they have a little chat and he's just like, he obviously has a past. He's like, of course he
does. Oh, do they go to the Lion Hotel?
Yeah,
I was thinking that they don't. They just find that out and then leave it.
No, yeah, they do. And it says like, obviously he has a past. And Seagal's there just looking into the distance. You think, you're right, he obviously does.
Yeah.
Look at him with his past.
I don't believe you came all this way on guesswork. Because he says, I'm an amateur, it's just guesswork.
Which actually is the fucking case. He actually did.
Yeah.
He did go there on guesswork because he's got no fucking idea what's going on.
No.
So that's
literally. But he's right at every turn.
But that is literally why he's there. Guesswork.
I like how when she says, you obviously have a past, Seagal narrows his eyes at her.
Yeah,
like Douglas.
Yeah. Maybe if every pen pal that you ever communicated with suddenly went quiet, you'd have a past.
Yes, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
He says, sounds like you're the one doing the guesswork. And then he leaves.
Of course, that's her job, isn't it?
Yeah, it's not Seagal's job. Seagal's job is to look after hawks.
Yeah, wounded hawks.
At the hands of Dinklage.
Trapped by Dinklage. And his merry band of men.
Yeah. Lato tells Steve about the major problem they have with human trafficking and how the thousands of young girls go missing every year. She tells Seagal she has enough evidence to hold him on suspicion of murder. I'm not sure about that.
I don't know.
And forbids him from leaving town until she finds out what's going on, which could be years, going from what she's just said a minute ago.
We just simply don't know.
She says, who are you? And he says, I'm just an amateur shooting in the dark.
I'm from the funding of America.
Mama.
Leslie.
It's the guy from Burial Ground doing the voiceover now. Seagal's putting on his other voice now as he writes United Alliance Nations on his notepad.
Mm-hmm.
I love in the book, Vern's like, why even do the voiceover? He doesn't even write the words United Alliance Nations out. He writes UAN. You don't even need to know how to read English. You just need to know letters. He's like, United Alliance Nations, Mama!
Oh, Leslie!
Knock on the door in code. It's the little boy.
Yep, shoots him.
Nicky.
Shoots him, dead.
Yeah, straight through the door, doesn't bother opening it. He's returning his sunglasses and he starts fucking leaving. So has that kid travelled from the orphanage?
Yeah.
Just to return the sunglasses?
How's he found the fucking hotel he's staying
exactly.
at? Exactly. He's a fucking undercover covert bullshit.
To be fair, Seagal says, here's my contact details and a picture of me in my underwear. So if you want to get in touch.
Yeah, but that was when he was in room 24 of a different hotel.
That's true,
hotel.
With a different pseudonym.
Now he's in room 34, because I fucking wrote that down as
yeah.
well, of a different hotel.
At the Lion Hotel, yeah.
Yeah, because I did check. It wasn't the same hotel. He hadn't just moved up a floor.
Yeah.
After he killed everybody, they were just like, well, maybe just move upstairs.
Yeah. And, well, was this the hotel we were in?
And try not to kill everyone. Wolverhampton. Yeah, and try not to murder anyone who comes in.
He's under this one as Royce Coolidge. Seagal says he taught Irena that code, and she must have taught it to little Nicky here.
To this little prick.
He invites him in for a nightcap. The little boy starts eating the wax fruit on the table, and Seagal asks him about the men that took Irena away. He offers Seagal the lighter he took from Faisal, which has the Turkish flag on it.
Mm-hmm.
See, why would he have that, Faisal? Why would he have a Turkish flag lighter?
Because he's gold. From the fucking embassy, wasn't it? It was a gift. That's why Seagal says,
yeah.
It's the Turkish flag. Now we're getting somewhere.
Sorry.
I said, that's the Turkish flag. Now we're getting somewhere. Yeah, but he says, now we're getting somewhere. Like, that's cracked
the case.
Oh, right. Well, in that case, let's go to Turkey.
Let's go and beat up Turkey. Like a Rocky in the freezers.
Yeah, but that's what he says. Now we're getting somewhere.
Yeah.
Like, that's fucking...
It's like solved a single thing.
Somebody's lighter. Now it's someone who smokes. Now we're getting somewhere.
I was laughing out loud by the time we hear the voiceover on Seagal as he saunters around the police station offering to help clean up bad camera footage.
What the fuck? Who's even asked him there? Because
why, like, is he there? That's what made me laugh. He's just a 7-foot man.
I hear you're looking for some help.
I'm hearing you're looking for some help. Like, it's a simple throughput issue. Yeah. You're like, what?
It's a simple case of signal versus digital throughput. It's like,
technical
what?
Bollocks.
That's what he says. He enhances the video. That these fucking experts can't do.
Experts.
These are like experts on digital enhancement can't fucking do it. Yeah, but he just like clicks enter and suddenly it's like, oh my God, that's Agnieszka, who I've never met.
Yeah, I've never met. I've no idea who she could possibly be.
The only time I've ever seen her, she was a burnt out corpse. That's her.
What I like as well is that is that when you zoom in, his fingers are like going 10 to the dozen, and Seagal has to act that. So he's there just his head's moving really quickly from side to side. Fantastic.
That's how you used to mime driving, isn't it, back in the old days?
Where
you used
with
to,
the hands just were just
constantly
moving
on the wheel, even though you're going on a straight road.
Yeah. I just seeing Seagal stroll into this scene in the middle of police HQ in his massive suit.
It's like, who the fuck's invited him in? They don't even know who he is.
With his voice as well. Fucking hell, it made me laugh.
It's a simple case of signal versus digital throughput.
Yeah. Oh, brilliant.
Tale as old as time and my computer hacking skills.
Back at the hotel, the little pickpocket fuck Nicky, he's looking at Seagal's detective work on a map with, you know, a load of shit stuck to it. You got post-it notes with words circled, pictures of Irena,
mm-hmm.
The logo of, like, companies that could be involved, thumbtack to it. Classic police work, which you don't often see from Seagal. You don't see his workings out. He usually just fucking goes somewhere and sorts it.
He's got a hunch usually, yeah, but on this occasion...
He's got a paunch. Yeah.
So how did you know? I've got a paunch.
Yeah, haven't you just?
Yeah, but he does. He does all the classic FBI serial killer profiling shit, doesn't he? Yeah.
Price doesn't go see fucking Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah, I mean, he does fuck all use, to be honest.
Yeah.
Because he's still just turning up and enhancing videos for other people.
Yeah, plus it's like the little lad who's like pissed because he's drinking the minibar, draining it.
He doesn't even fucking show any side effects of that.
I know, he's done most of the fucking...
The whole point of that scene is for Steven Seagal to tell people not to drink.
And he doesn't seem that bothered about
that, to
be honest.
He just says, you think this is clever. You want to get drunk.
And that's it.
Yeah, and then that's the
then
end
leaves
of that.
Him
and,
to
yeah,
it.
And he's not drunk, and which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Kid would be near death. If he'd been drinking all that fucking, all those
spirits.
It's
just spirits, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, but still, yeah, he's fine and whatever. That's just a little warning there for kids.
Yeah,
don't drink.
Seagal contemplates breaking his arm and throwing him out the window, but decides against it.
Which is good, because then we cut immediately to a game of chess
mm.
with Arena and Faisal.
The girls have been vacated from the warehouse and they've been brought to the palace to stay in, I guess.
Yeah, the big white palace.
They were asked to move, weren't they, once Seagal got too close for comfort.
White palace.
Diamond dancing everywhere. Yes, we get... Faisal's getting his suit tailored, looks at his chessboard, and lets her stay and play chess with him.
Yeah, she's just walking past, isn't she? She's walking past and immediately critiques his chess game.
Yeah, and immediately puts him in check.
Yeah.
It's like, this guy's getting outsmarted by a 12-year-old.
The little shit.
Anyway, United Alliance of Nations building.
Yep, here comes Steve. He looks smart from the waist up at this point, because he's wearing his suit.
Yeah.
And a like shirt tie, suit top, and then he's just got jeans on. He's like, ah, fuck it.
Yeah. Yeah, he's here under the alias of Mr. Demaray.
Mm-hmm.
He's with the International Education Fund.
That's right. He's always a funding man, isn't he?
He's here
that's
to
what
speak.
People go for, you see. Yeah. You want to give them money, they'll be accepting anything.
And that's what he's here. He's here for about donations. And the receptionist says that he will have to speak to Mr. Vice in finance, but he's out to lunch.
Mr. Vice, of course, was previously just seen at Faisal's White Palace.
Yeah, putting the recordings of the girls. He's taking them away.
Loading them all up. So we know he's no good. Steven Seagal, of course, being the tiny man that he is, instantly just leaves the reception area.
Yeah, he says, oh, I'll go and take a seat.
I'll go and sit right over there. And then when she looks, he's gone.
She literally glances down at the phone and then back up.
Yeah.
And he's gone.
He's gone.
He's fucking like huge, that man.
Like a will-o'-the-wisp.
Like a black candy floss.
Yeah, just floating down the corridor.
Floating along the breeze. He's made his way into the finance department, and he's looking around, and he grabs the address of the Atara Foundation that we saw earlier from the Rolodex.
It's the Rolodex, everyone. Remember the Rolodex that we were talking about? Remember that, kids? Yeah, the Rolodex, and we used to have to write shit down and that. Yeah, he gets it anyway, and he finds it straight away.
Did you have a Rolodex? We already discussed this.
Fucking Rolodex.
Kenny Rolodex. Is that not what they called you?
No, I don't know enough people to need a Rolodex.
That's true. Who's going to be on it? Me.
Yeah.
Vicey returns and he's told by the receptionist, oh, we're massive fucking...
Candy floss head.
Candy floss headed fuck is upstairs.
He's been in. Says, where the fuck have you been? And he's like, oh, I better go upstairs then. And as he goes upstairs, there's a tension moment, isn't there? Tension, tension, tension. And then as he gets there, Big Steve just walks out and says, do you know what? Fuck off.
Yeah, I was about to give you a large donation, but I've decided that you've disrespected me, and so I'm leaving.
Yeah.
Good day, sir.
I've been waiting too long. I'm out of here.
Back at Police HQ, Lato is piecing it together as well, finding out that Agnieszka came from a UAN school like all the other missing girls.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure why this wasn't looked at before, if all the other girls are from the same school things.
No. Nobody's ever pieced it together.
No.
It's because there's been a signal versus digital throughput.
Oh, that's
error.
True. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Cut to Arena asking about... hearing Agnieszka screaming, that's what I'm talking about. So is this in the past, this bit?
Maybe just somebody else. How does she fucking identify screams?
You can't identify your best friend's screams, Kenneth.
Pinpoint it to the exact one person. No, you can't. Fuck that. It's just a scream. Fuck it.
And that's what Azimi says. He's like, you don't know that's Agnieszka. Fuck that.
Exactly. No, it can't be, though. How do you know? I'm not having it. Anyway, meanwhile... Big Steve has infiltrated the fucking Atara Corporation.
Well, we see Vice. He's packaging up the tapes of the girls, ready to send them off.
Shitting himself.
Yeah, and he shits himself and then thinks, I better call someone and tell them that's exactly what I've just done.
Yeah.
And he rings the police.
Yeah, I've shit myself, he says.
He's turning stool pigeon.
He is.
The bastard. Although not a bastard, because it's a child fucking sex ring, so, well done to him.
Yeah, but he's in on it. It's not his first bloody rodeo, is it? He's been there. He's done this before, obviously. Mm-hmm. And he's going to call you in first day on the job and give you all this fucking...
and give you the sex ring tapes,
exactly.
Are they?
So surely he's been in on it for a while.
That's true.
Yeah.
What a cunt.
I think he's only doing it because of Big Steve's candy floss hair. It panics him.
Yeah, it would though, wouldn't it? It'd panic me, and I'm just watching it.
I'm scared shitless of it. I see it. You know, remember I go to sleep.
I was telling you about watching that horror film with my headphones in, and I was looking at, I did the same watching this every time Steve's hair turned.
His hair.
Up. Yeah.
I see it. I see the shadows in the corner of the room, and it's just, it's Seagal's hair creeping towards me to take me.
Is that what Vincent Price was talking about in the thriller video?
When it just grabs you by the ankle. Yeah. And just drags you into the darkness. It's his hair.
This could have been the Hell to Pay pitch that we did once upon a time. Anyway, yes, Seagal, he arrives
could
at...
Could be again, Hell to Pay 2.
Hell to Pay 2. Hell to Pay.
Oh, there you go. He's even better. That's the sequel. That's the pitch.
Yep. Seagal arrives at the Atara Foundation, as Ken was saying. Empty building. All that it has is a load of phones with answer machines attached to them.
And henchmen.
And one security guard.
Just one guy just wandering the place.
The first answer phone message you hear is from Vice, confirming all the tapes were delivered and the international bidding can commence now.
It is weird, though, isn't it? Is it weird that they're all on speaker?
Considering they've got like black market internet that they're using. Why are they all doing it through the phone?
Yeah, and why is it on speaker?
Yeah, very odd.
Anyway, it is. It is. So we hear all about it. So, and so does Seagal.
Yeah, and I like the where he's just standing there, they're all ringing, and you hear the bids coming in, and Seagal's just like looking around, like standing, he just rotates in a circle, looking worriedly at the
phone. So many calls. So many calls, all bidding for youngsters.
$75,000 from Washington is one of the
fucking
bids.
Son of a bitch.
London bids $1,000. $100,000. Sorry. Cheap bastards over here.
Typical. £3.
whilst Seagal's hiding from the security guard, he finds a letter from Atara Foundation's internet provider, Maxcom.
Yeah. .com. Maxcom.com. .com.
Yeah.
.co.uk. .pl. That's a Polish provider. Thank you.
Faisal, he's at some amazing Turkish mansion thing. I don't know where the fuck, what this is. I thought the embassy, but we go to that later.
I think it's like the ambassador's place or some shit.
The ambassador's reception.
I believe it's something to do with that anyway. It's definitely Turkish in the middle of Poland. I don't know how big that is over there.
No.
But he's got a big old fucking place, hasn't he? A big old house out of it.
I was meant to ask you, is this a common thing in Poland for 50-year-old men to send correspondence to young Polish girls?
Yes. It's how I met my wife.
Ken's wife is 17 years old.
Soon she'll be leaving school. Then finally she can laugh after our six kids. Yeah, probably. I don't know. I guess the whole point is that we just don't know. And nobody in America cares enough to check on it. So we kind of just accept it. Yes.
That's the real horror of this, isn't it?
I think it is. I think it's just like, it's Eastern Europe, so everyone in America will be like that. Fuck yeah, I knew it.
Is there a lot of child sex ring stuff in Eastern Europe? A lot of child being sold and shit?
I'm not sure I can comment on that. Like, in any knowledgeable capacity. I'm guessing so. I mean, a lot of them are set in that kind of area, aren't they?
I'm thinking hostel.
I mean, a lot of the entrapment sort of areas are Eastern Bloc and off radar.
Why is that, Ken?
Probably because nobody knows enough about it to query it.
Mm.
I'd imagine it's like, for instance, Albania. Albania has always seemed like, oh, they're brutal fucking gangsters in films, aren't they?
Yeah.
But if you ever look at the tourist brochures and that, it looks absolutely lovely out there.
Mm. But, yeah, a lot of those places look amazing, like Croatia as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Amazing.
But you just don't know, do you? So it's just like, yeah, let's just say they're bastards.
Mm.
Yeah. So
that's fair enough.
So I don't know. I honestly don't know. But unless you actually go and have a look, you just accept it.
Yeah. I'll take their word for it. I don't really want to go and look around Albania just to confirm.
That's fair enough. I'm not going to make you.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
So I'm not going to force you to. I'm certainly not going to finance it.
If I go by balloon, it'll only cost...
then maybe I can. Maybe I can help.
He asks if there will be a problem for his men and himself to be at the embassy, the Turkish embassy's ball, to which the man replies that there won't be. I guess he's the Turkish ambassador.
That's what I mean. I think it's his ambassadorial residence.
Ebo and Azimi, they tell Faisal that Seagal has ignored their messages, but Faisal thinks... he says that he thinks Arena is dead, so he won't be a problem. He thinks Seagal's just fucked off home, I think. He assumes Arena's dead. Azimi mentions Vice received a call from Leto about the missing girls and that he shipped out the current shipments of tapes. Faisal says, time to ship him out.
Yeah, so basically let's just kill him then.
Why, though?
I'm not sure.
Because he received a call from...
I'm not sure, but maybe they just don't trust him. But he's a big fucking player, though, in this, isn't he?
He's doing all the fucking shipments.
Plus, he's like quite a noticeable death.
In the Atara Foundation, he's like the head of finance.
Yeah, that's what I mean. He's quite a noticeable, like, death.
Yeah.
as is going to happen right
Evidence
now.
Up the wazoo. He's literally just, like, bringing them in and shipping them out from the company. I don't know. I'm not sure this is a good idea to kill this man. Anyway, no idea who this mustachioed guy is talking to Leto at the bar.
It's, if you're going to call her Leto now, then you should have called her Leto in the beginning. You've got a Lato all the way through until now.
Oh, Lato. There we go. No idea of this mustachioed guy is talking to Lato at the bar, telling her to stay out of trouble.
It's her uncle.
Seagal turns up, joins them, and Mustachio leaves. Turns out Lato's uncle. They share a laugh after Seagal insults him.
Yeah.
And they have a toast with Seagal again showing off his language skills with a Nostrovia.
Nostrovia.
They share notes on the case, and it turns out that...
He also gives us a Zhinkuya Badzo.
Does he?
Yeah. When he says, I'll drive you. He says, how many drinks have you had? She goes, fucking loads.
Yeah.
And he goes, I'll drive you then. We'll go and see Vice. And then as he gets up, he says, Shunkuyu Badzo.
Nice. Well done, Stephen.
Yeah. I wrote them all down because I was there thinking, he's really trying, isn't he? And these are actually his voice as well. It's not the dubbing. Shunkuyu Badzo.
Hey, Shunkuyu Badzo.
Nazdrovia. Yeah, that's not the dubbing. That's really him.
Yeah.
Really him. Well done, Steven.
Well done, Big Steve. they share notes on the case.
Kiyobasa.
Oh my god, this looks like the work of the footlong lover. they share notes on the case. It turns out that Lato knows the same as Steve, but Vice is meeting her to share information. They've agreed to meet at Vice's house, but Lato decided to go and have drinks first.
Mm-hmm.
And then Steve says, yeah, I will drive you there.
Thank fuck he turned up, otherwise she'd still be there now.
Because the plan was for... They get to Vice's house, and this isn't like mentioned that's where they're going. You find this out once you see a dead body. Like before that, they don't mention that's where they're going. Steve's just like, how about you give me the keys and I'll drive you to where you need to go? And then they go.
I think it was insinuated that he was going to be muscling on the case.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think she was...
She's like, you're right, I am pissed. You can drive me to this place, yeah.
Yeah, you can drive me to my work.
Two people get out of her car and walk into the house. One is Lato, and fuck knows who the other guy is, because it isn't Seagal. They've had to use a stunt double for him to walk from the car to the door of the house.
See his contract. Yeah. They ain't walking.
After finding the bodies of Vice and his mistress shot through the head...
Through the head, and you're to blame.
Yeah, it's Azimi. He's the shooter. He turns up, starts shooting the place up, trying to kill Seagal and Lato.
It is weird that Seagal just picks the gun up.
Well, yeah, he's not trained in forensics, is he? He's all data.
Of course he is. He's fucking CSA.
No, he was on the data team, wasn't he? That's the thing.
Some bloody throughput.
He's on the throughput team.
He's not on forensics. No, but he does. He's just there like that. They've staged a suicide, so he picks up the gun.
Yeah.
Yeah, brilliant. Nah, whatever. Anyway, it doesn't matter because they never come back to it. But yeah, it's So the gunman, he's still there, whoever he is. Who are you saying he is?
Azimi.
Yeah, I don't know names on this. He shoots Lato, but fails to be able to shoot the six-foot giant stood next to her.
Yeah.
So he's just standing there. Manages to shoot the little svelte female officer, but can't shoot Sasquatch.
Have you ever tried to shoot Candy Floss, Ken?
Many times.
Yeah, it's tough, right?
It's one of my autobiography titles that I threw in. Shooting Candy Floss.
Yeah, the Ken Be Wild story.
Yeah, I used to think maybe I could call it that.
Yeah.
You know, because it's difficult, nigh on impossible.
Exactly, which is why he can't touch Seagal.
Yeah, I suppose.
Seagal gets his hands on him, beats the shit out of him.
Yeah, but he still escapes. He just lets him go.
Yeah,
he does. Just runs off. He's like, ah, fuck it.
I think it's because he realises that Lato's been shot.
I think it's because he runs off and he thinks, I ain't fucking running.
That's also
true.
Yeah,
so he just turns around and thinks, right, what's going on here?
I mean, Lato's a cop, so you could probably just call an ambulance now.
Yeah, but you have also fingered the weapon, if you'll pardon that expression. Yeah,
another one of Ken's autobiography titles. Yeah, well, what I'm saying is that you could get an ambulance to help with the bullet.
There's no time for that.
Yeah, he's just shot in the arm.
There's no time.
Bleeding.
There's no time.
Seagal must pull the bullet out himself.
Exactly.
He uses a hot kitchen knife.
Yep, and his teeth.
And a spatula that he heats up. So he pulls the bullet out with the knife.
That's from his under siege days as a chef, of course.
Yeah.
So he finds the spatula.
Luckily, the bullet has barely pierced the skin. It's just literally sitting on the top there.
It's a really shit gun, whatever he's used.
It's a potato gun that he's used. Yeah, spud gun. And then he heats the spatula up and he has to cauterize the wound. And he does, and she barely even reacts to it.
Yeah, she's like, oh, cheers.
Be ridiculously painful,
yeah,
that.
Yeah, thanks for that. He's like, yeah, no worries.
What a guy.
Yep, they're back at the villain's place at Itala. Faisal, he's there, notices that his mail's gone. Like he's expecting a bill for the internet, and it's not there anymore. So he's like, oh my God.
Seagal.
Must be Steven Seagal. It turns out he was that letter that he picked up. But somehow he knows it's him. The gunman, he's come back and says, by the way, Seagal was there. Didn't actually shoot him, although he's massive. And he's like, right, shoot me in the face then. He's like, no. He's like, ah, fuck off then. Bit weird. I think it's just showing Faisal as like a lunatic. He's a bit unhinged. He says, you know, your problem. Your father wasn't hard enough. Well, no, he says, no, your father wasn't hard enough on me. Or something like that. What the fuck are you talking about?
Azimi says, you know your problem, Faisal. Your father wasn't hard enough on me. No, Faisal says, you know the problem with my father? He wasn't hard enough on me.
What's he talking about?
He's saying my father should have shot me in the face at every opportunity he had.
Yeah.
He dares Azimi to shoot him in
the
face.
Fuck?
Like some twat.
But why?
No idea. As you said, it's to make him look unhinged, but it just comes across as... So if he'd have just pulled the trigger, you'd just be fucking dead, would you?
Yeah, you'd just be dead. That would be the end of the bad guy.
To be honest with you, you'd probably take him up on the offer.
Well, yeah, because you've got to be assuming that if you don't, he's going to kill you.
Yeah, but... exactly, because that's what you... I assumed that Azimi is about to be killed now.
But he's not anyway, he just likes that. Go on,
he just looks at him in disgust and walks away, Azimi
does. Yeah, leaves him.
What are your thoughts on this villain then, Ken? You like him?
Not at this point. I liked him at the beginning.
With the rose and...
Yeah, I like all that. I like the affectations he has. I liked him when he was stood in that massive doorway because that showed patience because it took far too long for it to open. No, I do. No, I do like him. I don't think he makes any fucking sense. He's totally a nonsense character, but I like him because he's nonsense. So, yeah, I do. I like him as a villain.
Lato, he wakes up in bed, bandaged up, sans top.
Yes, yeah, and Steven Seagal sat right next to her.
Yeah.
Really, really close.
He says, don't worry, I closed my eyes during the procedure.
Yeah, little joke there, in case she's thinking he's molested me in my unconscious state.
Yeah, which, knowing Seagal, probably did.
Probably did, which is why he's denied it right off the bat before she's even asked.
Where did you learn all of this? To which he says,
I was in the Middle East. I've been around a couple of places, you know.
Winks at the camera. That's a classic Seagalism, isn't it? To be bashful about his past.
Yeah.
He tells Lato the people behind this are more than likely have diplomatic connections, possibly Turkish, and they will be after them, so they need to be careful.
Do you know what I like? I like the bit that we also see that little kid, what's his name, Nicky, is asleep across two chairs.
Yeah, sleeping off the hangover.
Yeah. Which I thought was funny because she's in a fucking massive bed. And not offered the kid any part of that bed whatsoever. It's like, you just fuck off and sleep over there, you little shit. You can't get anywhere near this fucking scene. Yeah, but it made me laugh. And he's staring straight at her. He's the closest he could be to that bed without being on the bed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Imagine waking up and seeing Steven Seagal looming over you.
Well, Kelly LeBrock, if you're listening, listen how that was.
Please wake up. That's what she used to think to herself.
Yeah.
Dreaming that.
Seagal changes his voice to tell her not to call her colleagues as it'll endanger their lives. At the White Palace, Faisal, he's practicing his special kicks. I didn't understand this bit either, because old Shepard from the CSA turns up.
Yeah, the bloody suit. The old suit turns up, calls him Colonel.
Yeah, Colonel. Where's that come from?
He must have. That's what I mean. He was obviously military. That's why he knows the cipher.
Or he makes fried chicken in Poland. Kentucky Fried Faisal.
He could do, couldn't he?
Yeah. Why is old Shepard from the CSA allowed to just walk into his fucking palace?
Yeah, because he doesn't even know he's there, does he? There's nobody brings him in.
No.
Says, oh, is this fucking guy from the CSA? Yeah.
Great line from Shepard.
Oh, brilliant, yeah.
I hear you're looking for a man who writes letters. Love that line.
Yeah.
I think that's the title of the chapter in Verne's book for Out of Reach.
Yeah. Fucking Anne Frank.
He offers to help Faisal put a face to the name and will be in touch. He says, your business isn't my concern. We just need to put an old dog out of his misery. So the CSA are going to team up with a human traffic ring to kill Seagal.
For no reason, because he's not done anything against them.
That's what I mean. Is Shepard rogue? And if he is, why is Lewis helping him?
Who knows?
And why did Lewis turn up earlier to warn him about the...
We just don't know.
What does any of this mean?
It's the shadowy world of the covert agent.
Of espionage. Faisal, he questions Arena about her new friend, Billy Ray, what's his name? Lansing. He invites her to accompany him to the embassy ball, and by accompany, he means chained up in the basement.
Yeah, they play chess.
Yeah?
They actually have a game of chess where he is so scared of losing, he drugs her.
Yes.
He's drugging a fucking child so he doesn't lose chess.
Yeah, I think he is losing when he does drug
her. Exactly, yeah. And then she sort of phases out, doesn't she?
And as she passes out, he tells her, checkmate. It's like, you
very
idiot.
Very clever.
Why does he decide to drug her? Is that because he's scared of chess or...
I think he is.
He can take her to the embassy?
I think he's scared of losing.
Yeah.
You don't want to lose a game of chess against a kid.
No.
Imagine that. They'd fucking tell everyone, wouldn't they?
I just upend the board before we got to finish.
Yeah. It's very quick, though, isn't it? It's very soon into the game.
Yeah.
So he's obviously shit at chess. He's really shit, and he knows he is. And she's got him.
Irena, before she passes out, she says, my friend Willie, he will come. You'll see.
Mm-hmm.
And Faisal says, I look forward to meeting him. And this is where I wrote the note of, I thought they already knew each other, blah, blah, blah. Because it turns out they have no fucking idea who each other
not
are.
Not a clue. No one's met anybody in this film.
Yeah, ever.
No. It's only the fucking bloody early on when he says, oh, yeah, well, you saved my ass. That's the only person who's ever met anyone else in the film ever before.
Yeah.
And, of course, Monsieur Delacroix.
Wes Craven. Maybe.
Oh, Wes Craven knows him. That's it.
Seagal and Nicky, they're scouting out the Turkish embassy ambassador's house. and they start following the car that leaves the place, and we know Azimi is inside it for a fact. They arrive at the Turkish embassy, Azimi gets out, but Faisal's in the back seat and he gets out as well. And Nicky sees him and fingers him for Seagal.
He does, yeah, because he asks him to, doesn't he? He says, can you finger him? And he's ignoring him. He says, can you finger him? And he's like, tension, because he might not finger him.
He's scared that Faisal will see him finger him.
Yeah.
And but... and Seagal's like, Lord, sweet, sweet Lord.
Lord have mercy. Yeah. Finger that guy. And he eventually fingers him.
Yeah, and Seagal's very pleased
and
with
it. And he's like, thank fuck for that. And he just drive off.
Thank fuck you didn't finger the wrong man.
Yeah, could have been worse. Could have fingered me. And I'm not accepting that.
Only a Reiner can finger me. is what he says. Because, mind you, a Reiner can't finger him. She has no idea who
she
he is.
She doesn't even know who he is. She doesn't know he's Steven Seagal.
Lawton can finger him.
She can finger me, to be honest.
Speaking of Lawton... No, Arena, she tricks Faisal and Azimi into letting her eat some of the hors d'oeuvres.
Yes.
As she's being walked through the back
it's
of the embassy.
Classic, isn't it? It's also another voiceover during this time.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. She writes a cipher using the hors d'oeuvres. This is ridiculous shit.
She wants caviar. Imagine that. Imagine a fucking 13-year-old Polish orphan demanding caviar as a snack. Yeah. Little bastard.
She spells out in cipher. This is a trap.
Mm-hmm.
And puts a napkin over it.
Yep.
And as she's moved away, Faisal checks under it, sees the fucking cipher and goes, I'll make sure no one touches this one.
Recognises it straight away because he knows ciphers.
Yeah, and instantly would look at it.
Because he's a military colonel.
Would literally look at it instantly and know that's a cipher.
And thinks that's a cipher saying this is a trap. That must be for her friend.
Yeah, Admiral Akbar.
Yeah. And sure enough, here he is. The weapons mechanism.
Seagal, he's at the Polish embassy asking for a pass to the Turkish embassy ball. And he uses his connections to Russia to get one.
I think you'll find he's at the Russian embassy.
Oh, I thought
that
it was Polish.
That is not the Polish embassy. No, I wrote that. But why is he not going to the Polish embassy?
Oh, because
he's working
outside,
with
I
the
thought,
police.
Yeah,
no,
I
it's thought... written in Polish.
Yeah.
But it is the Russian embassy.
Oh, I didn't know that.
No, I thought, why is he not going to the Polish government? He's in Poland. He's working with their police. He saved the life of one of their police force. But he's at the Russian embassy.
Yeah.
Thinking, that's just typical of you, Stephen.
Yeah, I assumed it was because the outside is in Polish, isn't it? Yeah.
No. He's at the Russian embassy.
So he's gone to the Russian embassy, and that would make sense because his undercover name is Russian.
And he even says,
I hate Polish people.
Our friend Putin.
What?
He even says that to the guy who says they can't help him.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Is that the blackmail he's talking about? Yeah,
and it's just like, fuck's sake. It's a bit obvious. But then again, this was before all this. Still a bit suspect, but, you know, it was before
all. Before all this, yes. We get a quick shot of Lewis back in the film. He's come to meet and have a word with Faisal. Back to Seagal, tells Lawton that there is a rental car downstairs with cash in the glove box. Don't stop for anything. You can get to the Czech border by nightfall.
Just get the fuck out of here. Go, go, go.
Check into the Capitol Hotel and give him a call. Nicky isn't happy Seagal is abandoning them because he's just a little orphan.
Story of his life.
Seagal hugs him and tells him to take care of Lawton. Nicky demands he gives Lawton a hug as well. We get some comedy eye rolling from the kid as Seagal begrudgingly hugs her. And then back to the embassy ball.
Not half as much as begrudgingly she hugs him, I would imagine.
Eren is sitting there and she asks Azimi, who's watching over her, why he wasn't invited to the party.
It's mind games.
Stop trying to get inside my head, he says, thinking like she's John Saxon.
Yeah. Get out. Get out of my mind.
Have you ever mistaken a 13-year-old Polish girl for John Saxon?
More times than I care to remember.
Yeah. Faisal comes in and Azimi, quite rightly, says he's the only one that can identify Seagal, so maybe he should be upstairs. Faisal responds by throwing him into the wall, and he says, that's why you're here. So either it's because Seagal will know what he looks like,
so Seagal would notice him as well.
Yeah.
Because they've already crossed paths.
Or he's a dick shit pussy bitch asshole.
Whoa.
Or whatever Seagal calls him in Was it Out for Justice?
Out for Justice. Chicken shit motherfucking pussy asshole.
That's it. He tells Irena that if anyone comes through that door, you know what to do.
Tell her?
Well, he's looking at her when he says it, so I assumed he meant her. He's meaning Azimi, who's...
Of course he is.
So he's still
What's
fucking...
she going to do? She's a hostage.
Well, that's
What's
what
she
going
to do, just like cry a bit?
Yeah, but it's the way he says it. It looks like he's saying it to her. Anyway, upstairs, you got Lewis.
Basically, what he's doing is he's transferring the threat. So he's making sure that she understands that is the threat. So if he turns up, that's what's going to happen.
Just tell her. She's 13. She's fucking better at chess. She can handle this shit.
She can fucking write bullshit in caviar.
Exactly.
In hors d'oeuvres.
Upstairs, you got Lewis. He's surveilling the place from the balcony. You got classic music playing. Faisal and Ebo, they're schmoozing with some diplomatic paedophiles. You know, the classic.
Yep.
Seagal turns up. He's got the Russian embassy guy with him.
Yep. In the Russian car, of course.
Seagal looks like an orchestra conductor in a long tuxedo jacket and no tie.
Yep, he's called Nikolai.
Nikolai Rodachenko.
Yep.
Lewis spots him, gives the eyes to Faisal, who makes his way over to introduce himself. This is almost like Mission Impossible, where the villain and the hero meet and shake hands.
Yep, he says, bring some special caviar for our Russian guests.
Yeah.
Meaning... bring the outrageously ridiculous fucking cipher caviar plate.
In fairness to Faisal, he watched her, so he'd already suspect maybe she's doing it. Seagal has no idea that the caviar
this
has been
be
tampered. But he instantly, when he sees it, knows it's a cipher, not just a decorative plate.
Well, I'd imagine Seagal studies food at all possible opportunities.
At all angles.
He would look at that for a cipher any day. If his wife was to bring him food, he'd probably look at it for, what the hell does this mean?
Yeah. Irena, meanwhile, tricks Azimi to leave the room whilst he smokes. And whilst he's out there, she legs it past him.
Yeah, Azimi's the same door. I mean, that's
a
stupid fucking escape plan.
Yeah.
Go and stand out of the only door here. And when he does, she escapes through the only door here. It's like, that's the same.
Yeah, she's running away, and that's cut with Faisal and Lewis searching for Seagal, who's vanished again. They eventually meet on either side of a locked door, Seagal and Irena.
Mm-hmm.
She's, like, trying to open it, and he's got his hand on the knob, trying to, like, listen it, isn't he? He's, like, listening into the door. But she gets grabbed by Azimi and taken away before Seagal can even attempt to open the door. Because he spots Lewis and Faisal, they're making their way towards him, and he disappears into the crowd again.
Yeah.
Which is no mean feat, considering he's 7 foot tall, 3 foot wide, with a Dracula wig on his bonds.
Yeah, but he's pretending to be someone else.
That's true.
There you go.
They mistake one guy for him, which has to be his stunt double.
Now we've got him.
Yeah.
It's not him. One of the chances.
Yeah, that's his stunt double. You can tell it's his stunt double that they've used there. He says, "Don't worry, hang in there, kid." As he leaves the place.
Yeah, which he can't hear.
He's found absolutely fuck all from that, hasn't he?
Yeah,
what's the point of him even going?
Yeah, and he's just left. He's just left and got in a car and fucked off.
He heads straight for a brothel.
What's the actual Russian diplomat? What's he going to do? Now that his car's just fucked off. So he's... And who authorised that guy just to drive whichever one of us gets back first? Just get fucking go, mate.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't worry about the other one. Because he does. He just fucks off.
Yeah.
Yeah. And anyway, yeah, he does. Yeah, he goes straight to the brothel.
But he sees Ebo, as luck would have it, he sees Ebo going into like a restaurant. And so he sees him.
This is a massive piece of luck.
Yeah.
As far as plot.
And he thinks, I know. I'm going to go to the brothel.
I go to the brothel next door. And I can only assume there will be a secret passage.
Yeah.
Or something.
Which there is. In the first room I check in. Is there many of these brothels in Poland, Ken? Because if there are, I might need to take a trip.
Yes. All over the place.
With beautiful women like this?
You're damn right they are.
God damn.
Yep.
He speaks to the woman in charge, asks to be shown around. She gives him the guided tour.
See, he asks for some sort of like historical information on the building.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bit weird.
Yeah.
It's a good job there is some.
Yeah. And he says, I'd like to spend some time with the lady with her hair combed straight back. Smart choice, says the woman. And Seagal instantly finds the secret passageway in the closet.
Yeah. He's in the Japanese room, of course, because it's Seagal.
Mm-hmm.
So he's gone to the Japanese themed room.
The girl turns up and starts removing her bra, but Seagal stops her, saying,
and
we're going to...
please remove mine instead.
He says, we're going to do something a little different. I'm going to pretend to be in a coma and you stand there looking at my dick.
She's like, oh, not again.
Yeah, you have to plead for me to wake up. Meanwhile, as this is going on, Lato and Nikki, they're in the car and they decide to turn back and look for him because Nikki's a little bit sad, a little bit quiet.
Yeah, he's
And she's like, okay, let's go put our lives in danger.
I'll tell you what, though, when Seagal's walking around that brothel, he's never fucking looked so happy.
Yeah.
He really does have a big smile on his face. He just walks in and he just looks so pleased.
What about the time that girl was, like, grinding on him in Marked for Death when Jimmy Cliff's on the stage when he goes to the nightclub?
No, I don't know. I don't think he looks happy. He just looked cool then. He looked like he was playing it cool. On this one, I think he's got older, hasn't he? He's just happy to be there.
What about in Belly of the Beast when that girl keeps trying to touch him when he saves her from the...
No, again, that's reluctant.
Mm.
He's reluctant, but obviously he's going to.
Yeah.
But this one...
I'm reluctant, but I'm going to. He says that to the camera.
I've said it before.
Yeah. Like Adrian Edmondson in Bottom, where he turns to the camera.
And this one, though, he's just got a big old smile on his face.
Yeah.
Walking through, looking at more, going, oh, yeah. Anyway, where are we?
The prostitute, she turns up at the bar Seagal saw Ebo go into. Ebo sees her and instantly follows her for some sexy sex.
Yeah.
I know for a fact this would actually work on most men, because us, we're all idiots.
Worked on me.
Because if that had happened and she did the big finger fucking
what?
Come to.
What? The big finger come?
Come to.
All right.
Like, you follow me. Oh, most guys would just be like, yep, that seems plausible. And as he goes
after a few drinks.
Yeah.
After a few drinks, yeah. That's why I can't go to Vegas. I would fall foul of that sort of shit in a casino every single time. Day one, me found dead. Dead and robbed. What a way to
go. Not necessarily in that order.
Nah.
He's counting his money out to give to this prostitute, and then Seagal turns up, smashes his head into the wardrobe, and gives the whole stack of cash to the prosy who walks off.
Yep, nice one.
He says, I need you to tell me what I need to know. Well, then I need you to tell Faisal what I need him to think. He promises him $10,000 in cash, Ebo, now, and $10,000 later after he's done what he needs of him. He's also got another new name now as well, Dr. Gray. He's asking if his wife and son have checked out the hotel, and he finds out that they've left him a message. And I think Ebo accepts his proposal, doesn't he?
He does, yes. Yeah, he takes that. The message, of course, they've left him is code in caviar hors d'oeuvres, so nobody knows what the fuck it means.
He arrives at a house, which is, I think, Lato's partner.
Uncle. It's the uncle.
Is it the uncle again?
Yeah, it's the uncle
same
again.
Guy.
Yeah.
Doesn't look like the same guy.
Well, it is. He's got a bag full of fucking guns.
He's got a carpet, but that's later. This is where he turns up to meet them, and they're at Lato's partner's house.
The fuck?
Nikki's happy to see him. Lato's saying Nikki wouldn't leave without him.
Oh, right. Oh, I've not even written that shit.
She tells Seagal he's going to need some real firepower, and she can help him get it. And then this sweaty fuck from the office will look after Nikki whilst they're gone. And then they leave the orphan on his own.
Quite right.
Ebo's back at the White Palace telling Faisal that the American tricked him with a hooker. The old hooker walks into a bar routine.
Yeah.
I know where he is, or at least where he will be. Faisal asks how, and Ebo says, I beat it out of the filthy bitch. He asks why Ebo looks so guilty, and he says it's because he killed the prostitute.
Yeah.
Faisal absolutely loves this.
He does, yeah.
And then he sends Azimi and Lewis to check it out. Lewis apparently is now just a henchman for Faisal, even though he's CSA. Uncle Mustache, he turns up with a carpet bag full of guns for Seagal and Lart.
Yep. He gets a Jinkuyabazo.
Very nice.
Again, from Seagal.
They head to the brothel in the room with the secret passage. And Lato asks, why all this for a girl you've never even met?
It's an absolutely beautiful motivational speech, isn't it, from Steven?
And Steven Seagal says,
I don't know. That's what he said. What?
you know, some of us have done bad things in the past. And once in a while, we find something that makes us feel better about ourselves. This little girl means a lot to me.
And she's like, mm-hmm.
She's like, that makes sense,
yes. That makes a lot of sense, and I appreciate that.
Lewis and Azimi and a few bodyguards, they turn up for an action set piece.
It's good, actually. Yeah, all the bad guys just walk in slow motion. Everyone else just gets the fuck out of there.
You got henchmen crisscrossing in the hallway leading up to the room like a bunch of cunts.
Yep. Never, ever be the first fucking guy.
Yeah.
That's basically what you learn from this one. Never be the first one in the eye line of the person you're going to attack.
Never be the first one over the trenches.
Yeah, he's just shotgun blasted to death immediately. Not even at the door. It's not even there. Yeah. He doesn't even get there.
I don't think guy's gun pulled this guy. He's just sauntering along, this man.
He's just wandering in going, what are we doing?
There was a laugh out loud moment for me.
What, the forwards roll?
Yes. Yeah. The roly-poly, which yeah. they got a stuntman to do in slow-mo.
In slow-mo as well, yeah.
And it's got a whooshing noise as
yeah,
well.
It has, oh, yeah. I've written that. It's got a sound effect.
Yeah, yeah. God, that's fucking awful.
Yeah, there's a ridiculous amount of gunfire as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's one guy unloads a whole fucking
exactly,
machine gun.
Exactly, yeah. People are firing like hundreds of rounds at each other and no one's hurt.
It's all right. He's hiding behind a sofa when he unloads a AK-47 into a...
Yeah, I enjoyed it. It was fun, but no.
I like there was another laugh out loud moment was the close-up on Lato's face as Azimi pushes a small shelf of
yeah.
wine glasses onto
yeah,
her.
Yeah, she's absolutely horrified by the impending slight discomfort
yeah.
of a little shelf.
And Seagal shoots Azimi dead because of it.
Yeah.
And this is where we get the sort of face-off talking to each other from behind cover. Lewis refers to him as Billy Ray, saying...
Some weird dialogue in this bit.
Yeah.
You write that down?
I've got it. I've got what Seagal says.
Yeah.
He says, Lewis, you're playing a whore's game.
Yeah.
You ain't nothing but a whore.
It's weird, isn't it?
Lewis is like, sorry.
It's weird.
And he says, and you know what happens to whores, don't you now?
Yeah, go on.
Whores always get fucked.
Yeah. So
Lewis is just like...
Lewis is gone by this point. He's just like walked out. He's like, oh, this is weird.
Well, Lewis responds with...
Yeah, go on. Go on, give us his response.
Oh, you're going to fuck me, eh? Like he's thinking, yes.
He's like, at last.
Finally, you've saved my ass so many times. Now it's time for you to take it.
Finally, it's the footlong lover.
Down a two-way lane. As Lewis thinks over the proposition of Seagal fucking him, I guess, Seagal fires his last bullets and has to reload. And this is when Lewis decides to do the old I've run out of bullets routine.
Yeah. Yep.
And Seagal says, I've run out of bullets as well, Lewis.
Yeah.
In just
that tone, yes. Yeah. Oh, that's a coincidence. I've also run out of bullets.
They step out to meet each other in the hallway, and Lewis says, I'm just kidding, I have a gun right here behind me in my belt.
And it's fully loaded with bullets that I previously told you I'd run out of.
And then quick as a flash, Lewis reaches for it, grabs it, pulls it round to aim at Seagal, and then Seagal says, hey Lewis, it's funny that you mention that, because I was also just kidding too. All I need to do is simply reload my pistol and then aim it at you and fire it. A bullet will exit out of the shaft and shoot you right in the chest.
If my aim is true, and it usually is. And I'm doing it now.
And he does, and he kills him before
Lewis
can even get a shot off, even though Seagal has the time to say, I was just kidding too, even though Lewis is already pointing the gun at him.
Yeah, thank goodness for that.
And Seagal shoots him dead.
Oh, well.
Having a small shelf with six wine glasses fall from a foot above you is enough for Lato, so she sits the rest of the film out, telling Seagal to go on without her, go get the girl.
It was a good effort, though, wasn't it?
She's got a little cut on the top of her head, and that's enough. Back at the White Palace, Faisal flips a table in front of Arena to get her to start stand up, and they're going to go on a little journey together.
Yep.
Seagal just fucking walks through the front door, totally unobstructed.
Yeah, I guess he sent all the bad guys away, did he? He sent all of his henchmen off to not kill him.
I think so. And he walks in on Faisal, and they both hold a gun to each other. And it's my favourite moment in life, says Seagal, when the predator becomes the prey.
Yeah.
And Faisal says, this is also my favourite moment.
When the predator also becomes the prey, as you just said.
But it remains to be seen who's the predator and who's the prey.
He says, oh yes, that makes sense.
And then Seagal says, it's okay, do not be afraid. And it's Irena who does look afraid because she asks Seagal who he is. And in the book, Vern does say that she probably imagined him looking like a Brad Pitt or something.
Yes, clearly. She certainly would not associate her pen pal to be Steven fucking Seagal.
Steven fucking candy floss headed Seagal.
6'8", 30 stone Seagal turning up like some sort of fucking villain.
Like some sort of beast from her nightmares. Seagal offers to settle this outside like men without guns. Faisal agrees because he's an idiot.
Yeah, that's what happens.
Blatant Seagal stunt double when Faisal jumps on him at one point as they're running through
there. Joe Pesci walking down the stairs, doesn't it? Like in Goodfellas, where he's about to be killed. He thinks he's about to be a made man. Like fucking Joe Pesci gets jumped. It's like, what the fuck? Who the hell thought, yeah, that'll do?
They don't even try and hide it. Yeah. He's in plain sight, this man. You're like, who the fuck is this guy?
And he comes, it's not even like a quick edit. He's walking down the stairs. Yeah. You can see him. He's on camera for about 12 seconds before. And you think, who's that?
Yeah, honestly, I watched it and I was like, why is Faisal, is Seagal sent that man in as a distraction?
Yeah, you thought it was some sort of decoy, but no, it's supposed to be him.
Joe Pesci.
It does. I wrote it down. I thought it was fucking Joe Pesci coming down the stairs here. Just walking down. Hey, fuck you. Yeah, but anyway, so there's a fight. It is supposed to be Seagal. Yeah, we do intercut with close-ups of Seagal. He gets a solar plexus blast.
So funny.
Which disorientates him massively.
We get the sound of thunder rolling as he gets elbowed in the
That's
stomach.
That's what happens. It's a solar plexus. You can't just say his stomach. He'd have absorbed that
tummy.
Straight away. Yeah, he'd have absorbed the stomach blast.
Steven Seagal's tummy. I love the look on his face.
Old Seagal's tummy tum tum.
Yeah, I love like his face where he's like, "Oh,
yeah, he's like, oh, me beef dinner."
Oh,
that's what he's saying. Oh, right in the brisket.
Right in the beef spitfire.
Oh, the bread basket. It's caught me right a cropper.
It's caught me flush.
That's what the voiceover says.
He reaches for a sword.
Obviously.
Seagal, as you say, even his vision's blurred from this elbow.
It is, it caught him right there, hasn't it?
And he gets a sword and we head for the best scene in the film.
Yeah.
And probably his best final boss battle since his heyday of films.
Yeah, he's got a sword fight in the courtyard of this massive palace. Why the fuck would he be living there?
Yeah.
Still, never mind.
I say it's almost an art film at this point. There's no music.
Beautiful.
High angle shots, lack of colour. All you hear is the swords echoing off each other.
Yeah. It's a standoff, isn't there, where they're both just sort of just there,
looking
at each other. How long would it have fucking taken them to both walk into the middle of this courtyard?
Oh, Seagal. A while.
He'd have got a taxi. Yeah. It's that fucking far from where he was.
I like how, Faisal is in the classic sword fighter stance, and Seagal, with his Aikido training, is holding it double-handed like
samurai.
And they finally start at opposite ends and they run towards each other, slashing as they run past and then pausing and facing away from each other when they finish. And Faisal, we see that it's him that's been struck the killing blow and he falls face first to the floor dead.
It's great, isn't it? Because it's like a freeze frame. There's a line of blood running from one to the other.
Yeah, there's a great shot from above of the body on the white floor.
Yeah, blood oozing out from around it.
Yeah, and then, as Ken says, there's a trail of blood leading to Seagal's sword and he's holding it out away from his body. It's great stuff. It's way too good to end this fucking movie.
Yeah. It's absolutely outrageous stance from Seagal as well, by the way.
Yeah. Well, the outrageous stance is when we cut to Irena, She comes back.
Yeah, she just suddenly turns up.
Yeah. When she goes towards Seagal, Seagal's stance has changed from standing still with his arm out to looking like he's about to take a shit.
I think he already had.
What the fuck is he doing?
I think he had at this point.
he shit his britches.
He just shit.
He's just shit.
Yeah, he just shit.
Yeah.
She shouts that as well. Have you shit?
Lord have mercy.
And he just looks at her.
Irena hugs him and they leave the palace, which is another great sort of high angle shot with Faisal's body in the background.
It looks brilliant. It really does. It's a really, really good moment.
Well, from the best scene straight away to the worst when we get the epilogue. It could not have ended on a high note. It could have ended on a high note, but instead they went with this. And it's Irena writing another letter, this time to Lato, telling her how Nikki and her are living in America at the nature reserve with Seagal. She says, William doesn't say very much. He spends most of his time by himself wandering the forest looking for injured animals.
And candy floss.
And candy floss to get extra height to his hair. We get a slow-mo shot of Seagal's stunt double walking through the woods in his trench coat.
Yeah, not even him.
We see Irena and Nikki, they're at a campfire when a hawk, the hawk that Seagal saved, in fact, at the start of the film, flies over to say hello. Good night, Ned, it says. Which I wish it said. That's what I thought when I saw it.
Boom, 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 boom.
I just thought the Three Amigos when I saw that.
That'd be great, wouldn't it? Seagal was just like...
And Nikki says, where do you think he's flying to? And Irena says, maybe he has a family too. Like we do now, because we're not orphans anymore. I will leave it to Vern to describe the last shot of this film.
Fucking brilliant, isn't it?
He says, the last shot is a keeper. The kids see a hawk, presumably the one from the opening scene, now fully recovered, and it flies away. There's a freeze frame on the hawk, and then a still photo of a smiling Lansing fades in over the hawk. You'd almost think that he lost the duel, and thus was a tribute to his memory. Not to mention, we get to hear the eagle cry again.
Yes, we do indeed. Yes, yeah, there it is.
And freeze frame at the and the freeze frame at the end, as Vern says, is absolutely fucking ridiculous.
Yeah, I loved it.
A nice laugh out loud moment as we fade into some soulful music and the end of the bastard film.
Yeah, and I just wrote that was fucking awesome.
That last shot with him and the hawk.
Brilliant, man.
Fucking
hell.
That
is such a fucking great way to end the film. It made me laugh like
I laughed
fucking
out loud.
Mental.
Yeah. It's such a... That should be... That's the bad movie called maybe the Thanksgiving card.
American just, Eagle!
Just Seagal smiling at an eagle that he saved.
Fucking brilliant. Absolutely fantastic. Really enjoyed this film.
What a load of fucking ridiculous bollocks this film is.
It is, isn't it?
Nothing makes sense. In the slightest bit makes sense.
Loved it. Every second of this film is fun.
Besides the ending battle, absolutely ridiculous from start to finish. Seagal makes wild fucking leaps of faith in his judgment and is proved right every single time.
Travelling to fucking Europe just because someone stops writing a letter to him. Brilliant. Let's go, go, go.
There's a bit in the Vern book as well that he says, wouldn't it be great if he got to Poland and it was like one of those, like, To Catch a Predator setups?
It's just the cops.
Yeah. It's like a bit harder for Seagal to talk his way out of that one.
It's alive!
So, Ken, is this a bad film?
Oh, yes.
It's 100% in
this. This is so bad. It's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah.
Yeah. Loved it, though.
From the ridiculous use of dubbing, literally offensive use of dubbing. Like, they have... You know,
he's not even credited. He speaks more than Seagal does, and we don't even know who it was.
You know, sometimes, you know, it's quite often in Seagal films they'll dub a little bit. This is just flagrant use of dubbing.
It's so enjoyable, this film.
They're ridiculous. They didn't even shoot Faisal jumping on the stunt double's back from behind. They did it from the front.
Joe Pesci.
Joe fucking Pesci.
Joe Pesci getting jumped.
The use of stunt doubles is just astounding.
I fucking love this.
But at least he didn't force his young female co-star to have sex with him. So
that's a start, isn't it?
So there we go. There's a plus
point. He's got that for him.
But yeah, I'm agreeing with you. This absolutely belongs in the bad movie cult.
It is brilliant, though. This is one of my favourites. This out of like, we were discussing, weren't we, which Seagal film to do. And I think I threw you a couple. And then you were like, what about that fucking pen pal one? I was like, oh shit, yes, that one. Yeah. And that was it. We just discounted the rest of them straight away. We'll cover them. Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to name them now. But when you mentioned this one, it was like, fucking hell, yes, of course it's that one. That's the one we're doing next.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't even know this film as Out of Reach. I knew it as Steven Seagal Pen Pal. That was how, in fact, I might even have that as an AKA in the title of the episode so people know what we're dealing with. What are we doing now? Are we ending or?
No, let's have a pitch.
Fucking hell. Let's move on to Ken's eager. Let's get him involved in the film pitch.
It's alive.
Okay then, Ken, what's the film pitch you've got for us?
Well, obviously, with it being Seagal, we've had a couple of great fucking film pitches from Seagal films. In fact, all of them.
It's my favourite name. Superb.
That was his Western, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I think the last one we did was Mark for Death. And we invented, or you invented, the character of Jake Fever, who was running a camp. He was running the camp out in the middle of nowhere. I want to bring him back.
Oh, nice.
I want to bring him back. And I'm going to use the camp background, and it's one of the former camp members has gone missing and stopped turning up to camp.
Oh,
and
my
that's
God.
Why, yeah, exactly. And that just triggers Jake Fever.
It's not Chef Chuck Norris, is it?
No, not on this occasion. They can be in it at the beginning, perhaps. We can bring in the same thing. But Jake Fever!
Diamond dancing everywhere.
Yeah, so this character stops turning up for camp.
Yeah. So instead of thinking maybe he's got a holiday with his parents.
Maybe he thinks maybe he's just doing something else, or he's got too old for the coming to camp. He travels the length and breadth of the world to find this child.
Oh, not America, the world.
The world.
It's not
Poland. Poland's not America, Dom. I don't know if you knew that.
Yeah, but this is camp.
Yeah, but he's in America. The camp's in America. Yeah.
That's what I mean. Like, she was Polish. Like, this kid's American, isn't he?
Okay, yeah. But of Polish descent.
Oh, he's going to Poland.
Yeah, he's going back.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
This kid was called
Krakaszynski.
Yeah.
Yeah, or something like that.
Carol
Krakaszynski. Yeah, that's the kid.
Yeah.
So he's off. He's off back to Poland to find out where Carol Krakaszynski's gone.
His dad was the Polish ambassador in the Americas.
Can be. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And he's been taken hostage.
By, I listened to the Mark for Death episode, by the way, the pitch.
Yeah.
And Tom Cruise was in it.
Right.
He's not in this one. I think we maybe killed him off. I can't remember the end of it. But his brother's in it.
Mm.
You know who his brother was?
Was it Clint Howard?
It fucking was Clint Howard, yeah. As sweaty fat balls. So he's back.
Yes.
And from prison... He has masterminded the kidnap of Carol Krakaszynski, whatever it fucking said. Should have written it down.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's off. Jake Fever's off across the world. What do you reckon so far?
I like it
a lot.
Yeah.
You in?
Yeah.
It's carrying on the legacy.
No, he doesn't just go to Poland, he travels the world.
Yeah, because he
not sure where Poland is.
Yes. He's travelling by balloon.
Stops in America.
So as soon as the wind blows, he's off. He's off course.
Yeah,
yeah. And then he has to get back to Poland somehow.
Who's the bad guy? I like running it for sweaty balls.
Who can we have?
Jean Reno.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. European. Yeah, you got the European touch there. Okay, he's in.
That's what they say.
Yeah, he's in. Who says that?
John Reno.
A lot. You say it a lot.
Yeah, most of his films, yeah.
As a European touch.
He plays Hans Rendezvous.
So a Frenchman's playing someone called Hans. Oh, their rendezvous is French, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, fuck it, then he's in.
Pierre. Jean-Luc.
No.
Jean.
Jean Rendezvous. Où est le rendezvous?
We got there in the end. He gets the help of an Interpol agent.
Go on.
Young, up and coming.
Yep.
Could that be... who could that be? Who could we get in? A bit of a name to go alongside. Maybe a bit of a... Is there any rappers? Yeah, I know he likes...
Oh, he does like them, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Let's have Post Malone in.
Post Malone is an Interpol agent with a load of shit on his face.
Yep. He's undercover, isn't he?
Yep. He plays Fellatio Buttocks.
Is that a thing?
Sorry?
Can you have fellatio and buttocks involved?
That's what his name is. He's Italian dad.
I suppose the buttocks bit, you'd be clenching them, wouldn't you? You'd be gripping them whilst fellatio is entailed.
This is the conversation they have on the plane. Post Malone with a load of shit all over his face is an Interpol agent.
Who's having that discussion with him?
Seagal.
Lord have mercy. Is that what he says?
I guess you've got to clench the buttocks. He got his voiceover man in as
with
well.
With your hands. Are you grabbing those buttocks? While the fellatio? Or what?
Fellatio!
That's a fucking never-ending story, that one.
And yeah, they're hot on the heels of what's his name? Jean Rendezvous.
Hans. Oh, we're going for Jean.
Jean.
Yeah, we're going for Jean.
Jean Rendezvous.
Yeah. I'm pleased with that change. Yeah, okay. But it's all being run by sweaty fat balls behind bars.
Yeah.
Is he due out at any time?
No.
I mean, why is he doing this?
Well, you gave me the idea, Ken. So
no, but this is
me.
What we do, though. I give you the very basis of nothing.
Because
and then you
he wants
build
to avenge...
upon it, and then I ask you questions, and then it makes it look like I've created a fucking great pitch.
Right. So
do you not remember anything? It's been fucking 2 years now. This is what happens.
No, I've just been listening to the old ones where you came up with the ideas, and I just told you
I've
how shit
come
they
up
were.
With this. I've come up with this. Okay.
So what he's done, he's avenging the death of Tom Cruise,
who was unsure
if he died or not.
I don't know if he did, but he was called Maverick Fatballs.
Of course he was.
Yep.
He's avenging him.
Yep.
And this is his favourite student from Little Carol, was Steven Seagal's favourite pen pal pupil.
Yes.
He's got lots of pictures up of like little childish drawings of a massive Seagal and Carol. Holding hands and shit on his fridge.
Who's playing Carol? Do we say that?
Just a child, a little Polish kid.
We're going to keep it with the child. We're not going to have like a teenage or young 20s.
What, still going to camp?
Yeah.
No, unless he's mentally disabled. No offence if you're 20 years old and still going to camp.
Could be.
No, it's just a kid, just a child.
Okay.
Little Carol, just a little Polish kid. We can get to work... Loads of hours.
For nothing,
yeah.
You just give him some salt or something.
Yeah, salt lick.
Okay.
Yeah, and we also need probably someone, because John Renault fights a gal, we need someone to fight Fellatio Buttocks.
Who's going to fight Post Malone?
Probably a few people, if you asked them to.
Mark Wahlberg's fought him before, hasn't he?
Has he?
Or did they team up? No, he did, yeah, in Spencer.
Not seen it.
Spencer Confidential.
We need a European man to go alongside Jean Reno.
Not Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Too old. He's a bit younger.
He's never gonna fucking do this.
Conor McGregor? He's European.
What the fuck is this?
What the fucking hell is this?
No.
No?
No, no. Unpredictable. Don't like him.
Oh.
Someone else must be European.
Michael Fassbender. No, we can't get him. He's a proper actor.
Getting Fassbender in for this.
No.
fucking starring alongside fellatio buttocks. Fuck you. How about it? What do you reckon?
What about... okay. How about Statham?
Kenneth Branagh.
Fucking Kenneth Branagh. Was he with the fucking Jacobean ruff on?
Yeah.
Statham.
Derek Jacobi.
Statham.
Statham? Again?
What do you mean again? When did we last have Statham?
Surely we fucking had
Statham. He's probably in the fucking original, to be honest.
Puerto Rico. Where's his character?
He plays Sheer Chance.
Oh, that's great. I like that. Very good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's in charge of moving little Polish boys around. You know how important that role is.
It's a weird job title, isn't it? But yeah, if anyone can, it's Sheer Chance.
Unbelievably hard to interview for. He got the role anyway. Yeah, and that's it, basically. The same plot as this. Lots of fighting, lots of going to brothels and looking through secret passageways.
You just guess are there.
Yeah.
Yeah, without knowing about it, you just think that's a bit of luck, isn't it?
We cut back and see Chef Norris and Rothrock and me and you just
Rothrock.
Fucking...
No, hang on a minute. Rothrock was killed.
Was she?
She's called Fanny Splits.
Was she?
Yeah, she was.
Were we killed? No, you lost your virginity in that film, didn't you? To
Salma Hayek.
Yeah, fuck
yeah, in a canoe.
No, you were just wedged into a canoe.
Yeah, we were both. I suppose wedged. That does mean... We were both wedged into canoes.
Fantastic.
Yeah, we sailed off.
Right.
You had sex with Emma Watson.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What the hell were we thinking?
She was called Lady Fingers.
What was Salma Hayek called?
Titwobbler.
What?
Titwobbler.
Titwobbler.
I don't know. I don't think she had a name.
God, well, we're casting ourselves having sex with actresses. Who do you think we are? Fucking Harvey Weinstein.
Oh, those were the days.
Yeah. No, we're not in this one.
No, we're not, no.
We just see Chef Norris cutting up some onions every now and again.
Totally unrelated.
Yeah. I just want to see Chef Norris again, to be honest. I like that character.
Chef Norris working at Shea Norris.
Yeah. I think Chef Norris could maybe turn up with some weapons.
But onions. that Jake Fever throws in the eyes of his villain.
No! Like his... we're not bringing Chef Norris from America just to deliver us some onions.
He's cut them in a special way.
No, no, no.
Assassin onions.
No, no, no. Save it for the kids' film. Fucking assassin onions. What are you on about?
Don't they exist?
No, he's got
I'm not a chef, am I? I don't know.
He's got his chef's whites on, his massive chef's hat, yeah. And he's got his knife, bag of knives, rolls it down, but it's guns.
It's onions.
It's not fucking onions.
He's brought onions.
Jake Fever takes
They're
them.
Easier to get through customs.
Well, of course they are.
Yeah, exactly. That's how he's so, like, potent.
Is that what he says when they're like, why haven't you bought guns? These are easier to get through customs.
Yeah, like, excellent work.
Not everyone likes onions.
Yeah, and then they throw onions at the bad guys and they're in their eyes.
Absolutely.
And they're like,
does absolutely fuck all.
No, because it hurts their eyes.
Momentarily, yeah.
Yeah. It's quite a long time.
That's a long way for Norris to go for a momentarily bit of pain from an onion.
Yeah. He's a specialist. He's an onion specialist. You don't go getting any...
Chef Norris onion specialist.
That's what it says on his passport.
God damn it.
Business or pleasure?
Business and shows him the onions. Fucking hell. He's not doing that.
We've all done it at passport control. Or showed our onions.
Yeah, well, you had to that one time.
Yeah, I know.
Right, we're not having Chef Norris doing that. He's dropping dropping off weapons in a helicopter.
That's disappointing.
And then,
how has he got through customs with weapons and a helicopter?
Because he's a chef. That's his Deliveroo business. That's how he delivers his meals.
With the helicopter?
Yeah.
When he's just got weapons in case he's hijacked by... Rival food companies.
Yeah, Gordon Ramsay.
Fair enough.
And in the end, he gets the little boy back. He's been holding.
Fucking Carl Weathers does.
Eh?
Carl Weathers.
With the help of...
Carl Weathers.
He's the head of Interpol. He sent Fellatio Buttocks out to help.
I thought Fellatio Buttocks was a... Oh, he's a good guy, isn't he?
He's Interpol, yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, I thought he was a bad guy.
Carl Weathers is head of Interpol. He's the chief.
Yeah. Interpol Chief Carl Weathers.
Yeah.
That's what he's called.
Yeah, he's sent... He's an old army buddy of Jake Fever.
Of course he is.
Yeah, they've saved each other's asses more than once.
8 times each.
Yeah. And he turns up actually for the final fight, Carl Weathers, to help with all the getting the kids into Chef Norris's chopper.
Yeah.
And the final fight takes place at a farm out in the sticks where they're keeping the children. In, like, pig pens.
I was going to say, full of pig shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice.
And Steven Seagal ends up...
eating them all.
Breaking John Reno's arm. Well, his stunt double does. And throwing him through a window.
Yeah. He shouts, Sacre bleu.
Yeah. And, throws him through a window. He falls into a pig masher. You know, those things they have.
the old pig mashers.
Yeah. That's a good name for a bad guy, actually. And
it's a good name for a band.
He turns him into pork pie. Or salami.
One or the other. Whichever's more believable.
Whichever's more plausible at the time.
To the meat producers out there.
Yeah.
Let us know.
And sheer chance.
Which one should he be? Should he be pork pie? Or should he be salami?
Yeah. There's one for you.
Yeah.
A bit of interaction for the fans.
How about that?
Sheer chance gets thrown in jail with sweaty ballsack.
Fucking sweaty fat balls. You said sweaty ballsack in the bloody Mark for Death pitch.
Well, you know.
No one, no.
I see.
As
Clint
we
Howard.
Discussed, Clint Howard, nobody calls him sweaty ballsack except Ron.
I see Clint Howard, I think sweaty ballsack. And he gets thrown in jail with him, and that's punishment enough.
And he shouts, I'll get you, Jake Fever.
Yeah.
And that's the end, which opens it to a third film in the franchise.
Fever and buttocks.
Buttocks fever.
Buttocks fever, yeah. That's what he shouts out, and then all the prisoners start going hog wild.
Yeah, they're like, woohoo, yeah!
And that's the end, what do you reckon? Happy with that? What's that called? What was the first one called?
The first one was called...
Camp
Kimono. Was it called that? Because it
might
Seagal.
Have been.
Camp Kimono or something, I think.
Could this be Fever Worldwide?
Fever Frenzy. Yeah, Fever... Yeah. Fever Unbound.
Kimono Undone?
Kimono Unbound.
Kimono Unbound. Because he's wearing it.
Yeah,
a kimono,
he's
isn't
still
he?
Wearing one, yeah.
There we go, then. Kimono Unbound.
Fucking hell, that's good. Done.
Film pitch is done, movie review's done, and this episode's done.
Yeah.
Thank you, as always, to my co-host, Mr. Kenby Wilde.
Well, thank you. Thank everyone.
Oh, before we go, I've got a death count
for
Out of Reach.
Hurry up, then.
How many deaths do you reckon?
12.
13.
Fuck.
10 men, 3 women, 9 killed by Seagal, 4 by Faisal. And now we're done.
Yes.
So what did you think to this week's episode? What did you think to this week's film? Let us know. The email address is badmoviecult@gmail.com. Where does this rank amongst the Seagal films we've already covered? Is this his worst? Is this his best? Let us know. All we want is for you to interact with us. Give us some of that interaction.
Sweet, sweet interaction.
You can also find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. You want to discuss this week's episode with other cult members? You can. You just need to search the Bad Movie Cult Discussion Group on Facebook. All links will be available in the show notes. And if you enjoy the podcast and are wondering how to support us, we ask that you please like, follow, subscribe to us on whatever platform it is that you listen to us on. And if you can leave us a rating or review, it's a massive help in getting us found by new listeners. You can find all previous episodes as well as written reviews of films not covered on the podcast on our website. That's www.badmoviecult.com. Join us again. We'll be back next week with a brand new movie review, deep dive and film pitch right here on the Bad Movie Cult podcast. We'll see you next time.
We will see you next time. Are you out of reach? See you. mercy. Finger that guy.